Morning, everyone.
We are gathered here today in McLeodganj Dharamshala with a wonderful group of panelists, and I'm really excited to be a part of this panel discussion. And my name is Sonam Dechen. I'm Associate Director of the Tibetan Center for Conflict Resolution. Served in the field of bringing the knowledge and tools of conflict transformation, communication skills, and listening skills, basic conflict resolution methods in the Tibetan and Indian community here in India. And we are very proud today because now we are organizing this panel discussion on conservation, the strategizing the conservation of environment in Dharamshala. The reason why we are doing this is because we feel that caring for the environment is everyone's duty, and whether it's individuals or organizations, it's very important for us to understand the actions that contribute towards environmental destruction and how we can be more effective in conserving our resources and work on the protection of our environment. So screen share chestunnachi. So for those of you who will be joining listening to this live, and from other parts of India and abroad. So Dharamshala, it's a small hill town in Himachal Pradesh. It's a North Indian state, and it's situated in the district of Kangra, which is one of the most populated and one of the bigger districts in Himachal. And Dharamshala has an average altitude of 1,457 meters above sea level. The average rainfall that we receive here just in the monsoon time is 895 millimeters. And the average temperature ranges from 30 something in summers to 10 or even lower in the winters. And some facts about Dharamshala as a place is that it is the winter capital of the state of Himachal Pradesh and headquarters of one of the biggest and most populated districts. The international peace icon, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, resides in Dharamshala, and also the seat of the Tibetan government in exile is in Dharamshala. And quite recently, Dharamshala is one of the 98 smart cities of India. Yet, the beauty of Dharamshala is something that everybody swears by. And just, we are lucky to be living in Dharamshala. It's such a place which is really beautiful. However, with changing time and increase in population, increase in constructions, and they have and people. The development is taking place where the people's ideas and the people's efforts towards conservation of our earth is not developing that much. So this is resulting in the change in climate. Climate change is visible here in Dharamshala as well. This picture is from just last year. This year in the monsoon, there was flash floods which great havoc, and there was a lot of destruction. It's not changing. Destructions took place, and as you can see in these pictures with the flash floods, what has happened, and lower down in the stream there was destruction of property. And so looking at these pictures, it seems like there's so much water. There actually is a lot of water, but then Dharamshala also faces a shortage of water. So we have been experiencing severe shortages where households and hotels have to buy water from tankers. And lower down the valley, there's an increase in the digging of borewell or tube wells. And the water table has really drastically gone down in the last decade. And this shortage of drinking water has prompted the state of Himachal to allot large budgets to prioritize irrigation and water supply schemes. So that's one aspect of it. And then when it comes to waste, so in addition to the local population, Dharamshala receives thousands of tourists, especially in the peak seasons. And as you can see, the government has made attempts in trying to minimize this problem with the installation of, I think, Dharamshala. I heard that this is the first city where these underground garbage, underground and censored garbage bins were installed, and we were all very excited. However, as you can see in the next picture, this is the plight of it right now. But Dharamshala is a beautiful city or beautiful small town, and all of us here gathered today in the panel are really passionate and motivated about trying to keep it this way. So I think this discussion comes at a very good time, because we need to start talking about how we can prevent Dharamsala from becoming another Delhi. So before we begin, I'll just introduce you our just a short introduction, and then we'll do a proper introduction later. We have with me as a resource person, Ms. Swati Singh, joining online. And in this group in the hall, we have people from various, I'm so happy that from the government agencies to NGOs have all gathered here. It's a very strong team we have been able to put together. So we have the municipal corporation represented here, as well as NGOs and schools as well. So we have a very we are looking forward to this panel discussion. Didi, okay, so let's start this discussion. I'm going to invite Nidhi. Nidhi. So Nidhi Sharma is the manager of outreach partnerships at Various Bodies in Dharamshala. Nidhi tells me that being born and brought up in a beautiful place like Shimla, yet with witnessing growing amount of garbage piles in the city and around the city, and especially in the rural areas, it made her realize that this problem has to be solved at the earliest. And this is why she joined Waste Warriors in 2009 to make a difference. She was initially handling the education department, and now she is part of the outreach and partnerships team and leads the model ward program in Dharamshala. Through this work, she loves engaging with the communities and businesses to spread awareness about the importance of segregation of waste at source, and helping in training waste workers by improving their livelihood and battle the removing of stigma around their work. So, welcome, Nidhi.
Thank you, Sonam. Hello, everyone. So, I would like to thank Sonam for having us all together today to discuss such important topic, environment. And I will be talking about our work, what we are doing at Waste Warriors. So let me just present my screen first. I have main screen.
Screen sharing enabled.
Okay, so I'll start. So Waste Warriors is an organization working in the field of solid waste management specifically. And our motto is that we are working today for a cleaner tomorrow, because that's the requirement that is required. If not now, then we will not be left with any time to save our earth. So the biggest concern is that the problem which we thought is local is not, it's global. Everyone is facing the problem of waste management, from rural areas to urban areas, from a city to state to a country and to the whole of world. So it's important to tackle these issues. And the bigger problem is that Waste Warriors is currently working in two states, Himachal and Uttarakhand. And our head office is there in Dehradun. So as Sona mentioned, that in Dharamshala, a lot of tourists come every year. So the population which is living in Dharamshala is added on by the tourists which come to the state every year in the peak seasons of like summers and winters during the snowfall. So the thing is that a lot of people are coming in. So 400 million plus tourists are entering these states since 2010. And the urban areas are generating so much of waste. Like, I just get scared looking at the numbers sometimes, like 1,300 metric tons every day. So this is a huge amount of waste which is being generated in the cities of our country. And it is not being managed. That's the problem. The generation of waste is something. It can be controlled by creating awareness amongst the people. But the management is also important. And that's, I guess, the main part where we lack. So only 40% of the waste is managed in all this, in every place. Most of the places in India. So the origin of Waste Warriors goes back to 2012, when it was formally registered as a society. It started in 2009. So there was Jodi Underhill. She's a British lady. She was traveling to Dharamshala. She saw the beautiful Dholadhar range, mountains, and she was mesmerized. But then when she looked at the garbage in the city, she was heartbroken. So she single-handedly started cleaning up the city. She went for cleanups, and then the local youth joined her. So that is where Waste Warriors started as, like empty bags, pair of gloves, and then a dream to clean the environment or clean the country. So our vision is that we need a clean India. We want a clean India where every citizen has a proper waste disposal system. It's not just to the dustbins or to the DMC vehicle. They should be aware of where it's going after the DMC vehicle. Is it being processed or not? So creating awareness and cleanliness all around us will also give us a sense of pride. Once a country will be clean, we'll have a sense of like we are proud. We will be proud to be Indians and collectively as humans. So that considering that we are cleaning the world and we are making it livable for the generations to come. So we want, the vision is to create a healthier India and most importantly, build a community which is inclusive of all, where the waste workers aren't thought of some other people, of some specific community. So that is all the vision is about. So the approach is that we can't, like Waste Warriors started as an organization doing cleanups, but we can't be doing cleanups all our lives. So the thing is that we need to have an approach where we are working on behavioral change, we are building a waste management infrastructure, we are strengthening our partnerships with government entities, with other NGOs and other bodies all around. And then empowering the waste workers, that's the main, like most important thing. So earlier Waste Warriors was when it started working in 2009 as mountain cleaners and then in 2012 as Waste Warriors, we were just doing cleanups, but then in Bhagsu. But then we realized that we have to move down. We moved down to Dharamshala, lower Dharamshala, for the reason that we wanted to work with the government agencies. So that what lacks in the government agencies can, we can help them out. We know that there is a manpower crunch in all the departments. So we want to help them out with all those problems. So our engagement includes a lot of things that the staff centers, like we have facilities, we have MRFs in our different locations. So we have staff centers, we have our field workers who collect waste, we have waste pickers who give their waste to us. Then we have self-help groups in Corbett. So we are also working in Corbett. So there the self-help group ladies collect the waste from different villages. And then the residents and the businesses. So the community has to take the ownership of their waste. Like Waste Warriors or Dholadhar Cleaners or Nishtha or multiple organizations like us can't be in a single city forever. So it's important for the communities to take the ownership. We are there to like help them out. But the leaders have to come from the community because the people of Dharamshala are going to live here and they are going to face the consequences of the pollution or the waste mess which is created by the locals and the tourists. So it's important for the communities to be involved. So our locations, like we are in the mountains, in the cities, in like the national park areas near the river, and in fragile ecosystem like Govind's reserve in Uttarkashi. So these are the different locations we are working in currently. And our model of working is that we have different programs to educate people on what we are, what we want to do in the cities. I guess that's lagging. Okay, no problem. So our models involve zero waste programs. So we adopt wards in different municipal areas and we adopt panchayats in rural areas. And then we try to convert them into models of waste management. So we work with the communities, with the panchayats, with the corporation, and try to bring everybody together to solve the problem of waste management. We work with schools to educate the younger generations because they are going to be the leaders of future. And through the extended producer's responsibility, we try to source the soft plastics back. So extended producer's responsibility is something that the big companies who are producing the plastic every day, it becomes their responsibility to take that plastic back and recycle it. So through that responsibility program, we try to source the soft plastics and the tetra packs and different things back to the chain, the circular economy, which is called. And the most important model, which I personally try to focus more on, is the waste workers' upliftment and their livelihood development. So if somebody is working in the field of waste management today because of some situation, that doesn't mean that he or she has to work in that field forever. So we try to give, enhance their skills through, for example, if somebody wants to learn driving or if somebody wants to learn how to make sustainable products, we help those workers through training so that they can learn new skills and improve their living conditions. So currently, most of the waste workers who are working in DMC are migrant laborers from Maharashtra. And that's the stigma, that locals aren't working in the waste management. So the important thing is that we have to work on vanishing that stigma, that it's not bad to work in waste. Waste isn't something we have to look down on. So the waste flow for our centers, so we have centers in Dharamshala, in Rishikesh, Corbett, and Dehradun. So these are the waste flow, like we collect waste from households and businesses, informal waste workers give their waste to us. We collect a lot of waste from cleanups and the dustbins which are installed in different places, and then from the tourism area, tourist sectors. So we have material recovery facilities in Dehradun, and we are about to build one in Dharamshala. So that's going to be the first waste management facility for Dharamshala. And then we have a waste segregation center in Dharamshala, and then village waste stores in Corbett. So there are different ways to manage waste in different areas based on being a city or a village or different things. So if we have to talk about Dharamshala, so this is the data from 2021 that we had worked, we were working with a ward in Dharamshala. So we worked with 650 plus homes, establishments like which includes of households, businesses, and other establishments. We trained them. We went door to door in every household and business, talked about waste management, and then we collected 120 plus million ton of metric tons of waste from different channels, which we have. We have eight different channels through which we source our waste, and we collected it, processed it, and send it for recycling. So it's not about collection of waste and then dumping it. It's about segregating it and then secondary level of segregation of waste and then sending it to the end recyclers. For example, the Tetra Pak has to be given to some recycler, and then plastic in itself gets segregated into 60 categories based on the color, the density, and all of these things. So we had worked for the waste workers upliftment. We have worked with 200 plus workers, where every month we give trainings to the workers working at ward level. We try to talk to them about their dreams of how they want their homes to be built, how they want a better life for their children and for themselves. And as a part of this upliftment program, we also supported the learning sessions and midday meals of 22 small kids in Dharamshala, like near to the bus stand. So the kids who were living there in the slums, we provided them everyday meal and education. So our impact since our birth, 2012. So these are the stats, these are the numbers. I won't get into them. The main thing is that it's important to save our environment. Every day, so much of waste is generated in India. There was a very interesting stat and also a fact that if all the garbage which is generated in India is put in trucks, we can have a traffic jam from Delhi to Kanyakumari every day. So this is something which I always mention in schools while talking to the kids, because that's something which interests them. And then we are able to visualize the amount of garbage we are producing every day. And the management is just 20%. Only 20% of waste is recycled in India. So it's important that we start realizing that the waste has to be reduced, and then infrastructure has to be put in every single place in a decentralized manner at first, and then sending it to the end recyclers. And outcomes is that we are empowering the local citizens and communities, because we want them to lead the programs, not the waste warriors. And we are providing a dignified life, like we are helping the waste workers to live a dignified life. We are helping in attaining the goals, SDGs. So most of our programs are in line with all the targets. And the important thing is to build a circular economy. Then that once something is generated, it has to go somewhere. So without partnerships and supports and government partnerships and collaborations, nothing would have been possible. So these are our funders and our partners, from government agencies to other funders like UNDP, Tetra Pak, and multiple. So the Dharamshala project has been funded by the HDFC Foundation, that is the HD Parikh Foundation, for 5 years now. And we were being funded by the Bestsellers Foundation, Dharamshala as well. And then there are multiple funders for other locations as well. And in government collaborations in Dharamshala, we are very closely working with the DMC, the Smart City, the Tourism Department, because the target and the goals for everyone are same. We all want a clean India. So we have to collaborate at some or the other point to attain those goals. So what we ask everyone to do is that, I don't think so, I have to ask us what's sitting here, because that's the reason we are here. We are doing some of the other thing in the field of environment conservation. So these are the few things we ask everybody and other people during our presentations and our interaction with people, that you should segregate your waste. Segregation of waste is must. And then we should reduce our consumption, and we should ask our local representatives the ones we choose, that what is happening with our waste. So we have to hold people accountable of things. And then we have to educate people in schools, in colleges, in universities, and from every age group, not just the kids, but every age group. And then we like to realize that how difficult is it to clean up all the mess which we have created. We ask people to do cleanups themselves. And then once we pick up waste from these tough terrains like Dharamshala, we realize that throwing waste is so bad. And that also gives us the confidence from stopping others from throwing waste. Otherwise, we are a little bit hesitant. Okay, abhi nahi bolna hai. Let's not get into some conflict. But once we started picking up garbage, we get that confidence of stopping others from throwing it away. And then, respecting the safai saathis. Usually in Indian households, what we say is, kude wala aaya hai. Kude wali didi aa gayi, kude wale bhaiya aa gaye. We never know their names. So it's important that the communication also shift, the dialogue also shifts from kude wala to safai saathi. So that it becomes respectable for anybody to enter that field as a professional. We want that field, like till now, it's very unrecognized. We want the waste workers to be recognized. We want them to have their own uniforms, their ID cards. They aren't thought of some thieves. Usually people don't let them enter their households also. They leave their garbage outside their house and then ask them to pick it up. So we are working, we want everybody to work in this direction as well. And then to make them feel good, we recently asked school kids to do something good for the Safai Saathis who are coming to their house. So I was really happy to see that the kids are giving them dresses, handwritten cards, sanitizers, masks, and all of these things to the Safai Saathis coming to their home. And then be a part of the change and join not just Waste Warriors, but any organization which is around you, working in the field of environment conservation and make this place better to live. That's the thing. So yeah, that's all from my side.
We just want to make the place like beautiful, more beautiful than we received it.
Thank you for your presentation. It's very clear that empowering the waste workers would really help in not just in making their lives better, but the cleaning process a more respectable and more important form of labor. And I think what you said about citizen participation while doing cleanups, as well as engaging with the government agencies, are so important. And we'll be looking forward to hear more about some of your programs in the discussion, following discussion in the afternoon. Thank you so much. And next we have Mr. Abhay Karki. Abhay is himself a successful, he runs a successful business here in Dharamshala. But on the side, he co-founded the Doladar Cleaners, which is an organization working to save the mountains from plastic and pollution for the last 3 years through open community efforts. And it would be very interesting to hear more about your work, Abhay. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Sonam. Thank you. And first of all, I would like to thank Sonam and have invited us here. Wonderful meetup. I think it's a very good opportunity for all of us to come together and share our ideas and thoughts.
How do I share this? Okay, so
can I control it? Okay, no problem. So yeah, you can go like 0, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I think Sonam is.
Screen sharing allowed. Screen sharing allowed.
Okay, no problem. Yeah, I'll just signal you. You can. Yeah. Yeah, it's fine now. So yeah, I'll tell you a bit about Dholada cleaners. We always say, you know, if mountains have pollution, we have a solution. No. So yeah. I can't see it here. Okay, I'll just look at that. Fine. So it all began with an idea that, you know, we kept seeing works of various organizations, mostly, you know, waste warriors, that they used to keep doing cleanups and everything in our mountains. And even I was a volunteer for a very long time for waste warriors when they had their office in Bhagsunam. And I used to see, you know, a lot of people from outside used to come here and volunteer with them, you know, for the cleanups and everything. And that's when, you know, we started thinking that, you know, it's our area and, you know, people from our area should be more concerned about our mountains and, you know, protecting the environment of at least this city. So that is when, you know, you can start to the next one. That is when, you know, we had an idea to, you know, get the local community involved with this whole thing, because we wanted to bring people together and be more responsible about this. Because if the people of this area are responsible or you know, concerned about the mountains, the people from outside will automatically get, you know, more aware. If it's the residents of the people of the place who get to decide the do's and don'ts of your area. That's what we think. You know, like if in your house you make a rule that no one can come inside with their shoes, everyone has to open their shoes outside, right? Same way in the villages and our cities, you know, if the people of the village decide or the city decide that, you know, no one should throw garbage and the whole system is like that, no one coming from outside is going to do that. So we are very quick to blame the tourists and everyone, but our main focus is in the local communities, so that, you know, if everyone is aware and there's no garbage anywhere, people coming from outside will also not do that, right? So this is where we started in 14th July, back in 2019. Before this, we had a meeting in 2018, like in the Diwali of 2018, and a few of us came together and decided that we want to do something like this. And we all decided that we'll create a group like this, and we just randomly thought that we'll do one cleanup. We never thought that we'll, you know, build it into such a huge team or some organization like that. We just wanted to do one cleanup. But after that, you know, 1 year passed, things kept going, you know, people got busy with their lives. And finally, we again kept saying, you know, we want to do this, but somebody was busy somewhere. But finally, you know, on 14th July, we started this, and this was a handmade poster that we put out there. And on that first day, we went to Indranag, and we kept waiting for people to come. You know, we had kept the time as 9 a.m., but as you know, nobody comes on time. So even I came late today. So sorry for that. But yeah, so we went there at 9 a.m. and we kept waiting for the people to come, but no one came. You know, we kept waiting, but around 11 a.m., you know, a few people started coming. We had put it all on social media, and we thought that people will see it and come. But we kept waiting. One or two people came, but suddenly, you know, till 11:30, a lot of people came. And, you know, you can go to the next slide. And suddenly, you know, there was a huge group of people that had joined us that day. And this was the first cleanup that we had done. And it was so good to see, you know, so many local people, and mostly youth, they had come and joined us. And it was very, this was the point when we, you know, thought that, okay, this can become something big and we can do something more about it. And that was the point when we thought, okay, let's continue this and keep doing this. And then we next week also, we conducted another cleanup, and even more people came, you know. And it was very heartwarming to see that the local people are getting involved, and the local people want to, you know, keep their city and their mountains clean, and they want to take some initiative. So this was the beginning of our whole campaign. And you can see the local community started getting involved. All these people, these are all locals, all from various parts of Dharamshala, you know, from someone from the main city, some people from the villages. We even had some people come from Kangra and Palampur and all those places. So it was very good to see that, you know, people are getting involved. And this is what we wanted, actually. We wanted to involve the local community, and we wanted, like I said, you know, if we decide our do's and don'ts, the people coming from outside, they will not engage in much littering and such activities. So that was our main motive, to, you know, involve the local communities. And I think that's where we have been working the most. So we picked up a small village in Dharamshala. This is Indranag village. It's also known as Tau Panchayat. We picked this village because this is the smallest panchayat in our Dharamshala area. And it was a bit easier for us. It's an upcoming tourist spot. We have paragliding activities there, and the road is also connected to Makrotganj in the coming years. So we thought, you know, it's a good time to focus on this area because it's a small space, and it is also an upcoming tourist hotspot. So if we can create a model in this place, we can replicate this model in other places as well later. So that was our objective. So can we go ahead? So yeah, and then these are the other activities that we have engaged with. You know, this was a global climate strike that we did in Makrotganj. We had a huge number of people who joined us. A lot of people from Tibetan community also had joined us. A lot of people from other organizations had also joined us. I think there was like 100-150 people who had joined us, and we had, you know, covered the entire main square of Makrotganj, and we had all lie down there, and then we were giving this message to, you know, save the climate. And it was a very big event. And then we did that again next year. This one we had a march. In this what we did is we invited a lot of schools to join us, and a lot of local schools, they came us. We had a march from bus stand of Dharamshala to Kacheri, and there was a huge big long line of students that we had involved. We thought, you know, because it's the youth which is the most important for us right now, because the people who have grown up, their minds are very hard to change. But if the kids, they know from the beginning that this is the right thing and this is the wrong thing to do, and this is how we can save our environment, it's good for us. It's good for our future. So we involved a lot of students in that, and then we keep doing tree plantation drives. Even before we had formed Dhaladha Cleaners, we were doing tree plantations even 2 years or 3 years before that. So every year, so if you say Dhaladha Cleaners is almost 3 years, tree plantation drives we've been doing for almost now 6 or 7 years. So we came together as a group of friends or known people, and we used to plant trees. In this, we had a lot of other organizations also join us. You know, like you can say Animal Rescue. There's an NGO called Dharamshala Animal Rescue. They had joined us. There's a hotel here, Hayat. They had also joined us. And a few other organizations also joined us in this one. But previously, also, we kept doing a lot of tree plantation drives. And the main supporter for us in this has been the Forest Department. They've always supported us. They've always given us trees and place to, you know, plant those trees. And yeah, they've been very supportive in this regard for us. And yeah, and we keep doing a lot of track cleanups also. I think Waste Warriors was the main source of inspiration for us. For this thing, we have done cleanup in Kareri Lake, and recently in Tatharna Trek. And we have, in this also, you know, again, local boys and girls, youth have come forward, and, you know, they have participated very enthusiastically. We always think that, you know, these things should not be boring. These things should be fun. If we make them boring, you know, people will not be so much involved in this. So we always try to make our cleanups and our plantation drives, everything very much fun. See, like we made these things from the bottles that we collected. We wrote that no trash, and you can see a lot of bottles there. This is just a small area of Indranag, which is the smallest village of Dharamshala area, and you can see huge piles of bottles there. And it's very scary to think, you know, that if from such a small area, such huge pile of trash is coming out, what will be the scenario in other areas where there's a lot more population and a lot more people coming? So this is what we are afraid of, and this is what we are trying to fight against. And we like I said, you know, we keep things very light and very fun. So we keep making these boards like these, which are fun to read and catchy, and maybe, you know, they can also bring some change in the mindset of people. So it says, "Kha pikar jo filaye gand, wo kehlaye murkhanand." So we keep very things very light. We don't think keep things very serious, but at the same time, it's a very serious issue that we are facing, and we try to fight, but in a very, you know, fun way. To say, you know, we have collaborated with Based Warriors, with Nishtha, and several other organizations, and we are very thankful that we are maybe the youngest organization here, but we have had help from all of them, and they've been very supportive.
Thank you
very much.
In Abhay's presentation as well, I think engaging the locals and getting the locals to take ownership of their own trash is the key. And I think your idea of adopting a small village so that if the model goes well, it can be replicated to other bigger villages and localities is a very good idea. And your climate action activities that you've done is also very inspiring. So thank you very much, Abhay. So the next panelist in the lineup, I'm very happy to invite
Tenzin
Pamula.
Mrs. Tenzin Pamula.
She is an English mentor, an English resource teacher at the Tibetan Children's Village School. And she has been working in the school for the past 32 years. And on top of her teaching job, she is a very passionate environmentalist. And she inspires the students and others to reduce their waste, reuse, and recycle. She started the Trash for Education program in 2008. In 2010, she was invited to speak about her work at the Conference on Education and Environment held in Sikkim, which was in the presence of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. She's also a recipient of the Kangsa Desi Environment Award in 2012. Beginning from 2012, she started making eco-enzymes. And she teaches making this to the local people and students as well. And during her yearly school visits, she talks to the students and the local people on what she calls the four E's: ethics, environment, education, and eating right. She is invited to talk to various Tibetan and Indian audiences by renowned organizations. And we at TCCR are so happy that you have agreed to be one of our panelists. So without much ado, I invite Gaitan Sipamula.
Tashtelik, it has been a privilege for me to be here as one of the panelists, and I am not from an organization. I'm a simple English teacher at the Tibetan Children's Village School. And this work, environment work, has been so much inspired by reading books by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. So His Holiness the Dalai Lama has been my biggest inspiration in whatever work I do, okay, in my school work, or environment work, or the everyday kindness we practice. Everything has been inspired by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. So in one of his books, he has mentioned that as a once you have this precious human life, you have, unlike the animals, you have the ability, you have the opportunity, and you have the responsibility, these three potentials. And that was in 2009 when I started reading His Holiness the Dalai Lama's books. And I was so inspired, I questioned myself, do I have all these potentials in me? And I did have. So from that very year in 2009, I thought, it's not right for me just to do the work I'm paid for. I need to do something, you know, not like doing the work you are paid for. It's not enough. You must do something else for the others. All right. So because whatever luxurious or whatever facilities you are enjoying yourself, it's all from the kindness of other people. So that's why I felt that I must do so much for other people to repay their kindness and to make the best of my precious human life while I am fit and fine. I'm fit and fine, and I felt I had so much potential in myself. So from 2009, I started, you know, the environmental work because I saw this Tetra Pak milk cartons everywhere in the school, because each home, 39, 40 homes are being supplied with this Tetra Pak milk. So throwing them away every single day, you know, it really ached me. I thought I really must do something about it. Of course, there's so much garbage, but then I thought, to be specific, just I'll tackle with one garbage, and then Tetra Pak milk cartons are the most. So I started making, using these, you know, as teaching aids for the children to learn English. I brought some materials here. And this Tetra Pak, now from the year, when I first started the Tetra Pak, I used to go from home to home for collection with a big sack. There's, you know, you don't feel bad at all because, you know, you feel that it's your responsibility. You need to do something. So I've been getting up early in the morning with a sack. And the first time the children are saying, Kela, you're here with a sack. You know, they see a strange sight. Yes, I said, I've come to collect your, in the class I teach, but you know, now I've come to collect your Tetra Pak milk cartons, you know. And then gradually the whole school came to really, you know, notice the work I'm doing, and then they started, you know, collecting these for me. And first few years, the Tetra Pak cartons were very dirty, you know, rotten milk. And sometimes when I, you know, when I take these to the office, you know, when I lift these up, oh my God, the, you know, rotten milk spills on your well-dressed, you know. So this is what happened. Now these days, the Tetra Pak milk cartons use very clean, very dry. You know, everybody is taking so much care because they know that I'm working with this, I'm making materials for the children. So I'm getting a good support. You know, I've been able to influence so many people, you know, not to just throw them, dump them in the garbage, but somebody in the school is taking care of these. So outside my house, you know, where I live, staff quarter, outside, you'll know where my house is, Tetra Pak outside. Again, everybody will know where my office is because Tetra Pak outside, okay? So, and then since we make teaching aids, we wash them, dry them in the sun, they are very clean. So we pack them, and then especially during the rainy season, we won't be able to wash them. So we have them ready. So we have raw materials for free to make teaching aids for the children. So I've been doing it for the past now, how many years? Since 2009. And it's going on, and children know. And then children, many of the children come to help me. And sometimes the teachers, if they have students who needs punishment, I ask them to send the children to my office to dry the, to cut these, wash them and all. Yeah. So children enjoy doing this. Yeah. So this is about the Tetra Pak milk and juice cartons. And then I've started making eco bricks also now. And I brought some samples here. in one bottle, oh my, the amount of garbage, you know, which goes inside, you won't believe. So much plastic you can stuff into it. So I thought it's a really good way of managing plastic waste, right? So as like plastic waste, you can't stop plastic manufacturers from, you know, supplying this. But then when they come to you, your responsibility to do something with it, not just throw away so easily, you know, adding up to the daily garbage, you know. And of course, as Dolar, you said, like, it's true that there's so much of it. How much, you know, how many days you go and collect all these? So it has to start from, sometimes I feel climate change is how you live your lives day by day, individual by individual. So my slogan or motto is one individual, one day. One individual can do so much. You have so much potential. Okay. And then one day is very precious. You must start. One day is very precious. So every one day, you know, adds up to many years. So that's why you should not waste this one day. This is what I've been telling the children always, the power of one individual, the power of one individual, and the power of one individual and power of one day. Okay. So that's why I feel that when I can do so much, you know, just one individual, everybody can do the same, especially as His Holiness the Dalai Lama says, when you, you know, from the, you know, when you were born, other people looked after you just because of the kindness of other people. You are alive now. You have been brought up, you know, just because of the kindness of other people. When you get sick, other people will look after you, you know. Always, any problem, there'll be other people looking after you. And the medicines you eat, other people, you know, all, whatever, the electricity, the house, the hall, beautiful, everything, the chair you are sitting on, everything is here because of the kindness of other people. So when you were helpless, when you were born, your parents and other people helped you. And when at the end of your life, when you die, when you become sick, again, other people will be there to help you and support you. So in between, as this is His Holiness the Dalai Lama's mass, in between, when you are fit and fine, why don't you practice kindness? You know, so that's why I'm trying to do this. I'm trying, and I do have all these potentials. I can do so much as an individual. So I really sometimes wonder why other people are not doing, but I should not worry about it at all. As His Holiness Dalai Lama and Shanti Deva said, why be unhappy if you can't, you know, if there's no remedy, you know? And even if there is remedy, why worry about it? So you do it, whatever you can. So if every individual thinks the same way, definitely there won't be, you know, much trouble in the world. Okay, so this is what I feel. So Tetra Pak milk cartons and then eco segregation and the plastic, how do you manage plastic? So second one is added. One is minimizing the volume of plastic, minimizing the volume. So I have brought here from home, if you can do the segregation, if you can do the segregation at home, you know, plastic, and if milk plastics, you can wash them, dry them in the sun, you know, and keep them clean. Or you can cut and make them into eco bricks, or you can fold them into as small a size as possible. This is what I've taught the children. So big, you know, snake wrappers, you can turn them into this small size. So you can, you know, minimize the size. And this really minimizes, reduces the volume of garbage. And I also tell people that, for example, jam bottles, peanut, whatever, you know, wash them, clean them, use up all. Don't leave even a single bit of jam in it or whatever it is, because you have paid for it. You're wasting money. You know, put your finger inside and lick every, you know, don't leave anything, because everything is money inside. you know, and resources. So many people have worked hard and then wash it dry, dry it. And if you want to reuse it, okay, for masala container or anything use, otherwise you can, you know, throw clean garbage because other people are working. Other people like you who doesn't want to suffer, who doesn't want to, you know, work with dirty, filthy things, but also you, like you, wants to always work with something clean. So always think about the people who are working with garbage. That's very important. And if you have bottles, you know, sometimes bulbs, broken bottles, tie them nicely, you know, in a plastic or box or whatever, so that the people working will not get hurt with these. So we really need to think about these, you know. When I see this, you know, they seem to be, you know, oh, inconsequential, but then they mean a lot to the people who are really working with garbage. So with this sense, and His Holiness the Dalai Lama says, you should have a heart of a servant. You know, work with garbage, work in the garbage, you know, and try to do as much as possible, you know, to throw clean garbage, to dispose of clean garbage, and to, you know, less garbage also, and the amount also. So try to always have this. This has been very effective for me. Always try to have a heart of a servant, okay? Not subservient, okay? Always promoting yourself, you know, just a servant to benefit others. So I always have this sense of, you know, serving others, especially in the government. For example, if you work for the environment, you are working for the whole world, you know. So it's, you know, you, for example, if you just wash a Tetra Pak carton, you are working for the world. You're working for the whole environment. It looks inconsequential, but then it has a big impact on the world, I feel. So that's why I feel like, so as I told you, okay. So, yes, the next one, so this what I've talked about is dry garbage. Now, in 2012, I've been asked by the Tibet House to visit the Tibetan settlements in North to give a talk on management of dry garbage. And my partner had to talk about wet garbage, so I learned from him, making eco enzyme, because he was going to talk, he talked about this. And since 2012, when I first learned, I started making eco enzyme. Until to this day, I'm making eco enzyme. And then I get to use now Bisleri bottles. I get all the Bisleri bottles again. Okay. And when there are parties, I go and pick up Bisleri bottles. And then especially these days, they use much of the small mineral water. So good for me, because people always come to ask me for enzyme. No, I used to previously give in the 1 liter Bisleri. So now I have reduced the amount to make it more valuable. So I keep collecting all these, you know. So what I want to say is, in a nutshell, you as an individual with this precious human life, you have so much potential. So let us all together use the potentials we have when we are alive and kicking, okay? One day, you never know when you are going to go away from this world, you know? So let's make the best use of it. I'm very happy to have like-minded people to meet and talk about solutions for the climate change. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gela. So it's very inspiring. And we all know that the initiative of one person has really made so much difference in a large area, in a huge chain of schools where right now the students are very inspired and they are into making enzymes as well as segregating waste garbage. And now we have with us, We are very thankful that Mr. Surinder Shukla from the Municipal Corporation of Dharamshala has joined us. And he is in charge of the solid waste management at the Municipal Corporation. And today he'll be speaking about some of the most pressing issues that's faced in Dharamshala. So over to you, Surinder ji.
Okay, thank you everybody. Solid waste management means ek aisa issue hai matlab iska endless discussion. Apart from main duty urban mein एमसी से शुरू होती है, तो मैं एमसी के बारे में बताना चाहता हूँ। हम जो है धर्मशाला नगर की पॉपुलेशन है एट प्रेजेंट 63,000 पॉपुलेशन। हमारे पास जो सफाई मित्रा है, सफाई मित्रा जो डेली आप देखते हैं रोड में क्लीनिंग करते हैं, हम 270 लोगों से ये काम करते हैं। इसके साथ ही हमने 27 व्हीकल इंगेज की हुई है और इसमें एक दो तीन साल पहले हमने एक इंटरेस्टिंग पार्ट जोड़ा था। पहले होता था क्लीनिंग मींस रोड में झाड़ू लगाया और चले गए, यहीं से कूड़ा उठाया और वहीं पे। इस टाइम में हमने तीन साल पहले एक डोर टू डोर गार्बेज कॉन्सेप्ट जो शुरू किया इंक्लूड्स के, मतलब आपके डोर स्टेप से ही गार्बेज उठाया जाए। और उसका एक और पार्ट है कि सेग्रीगेशन में, जैसे कि मैम बोल रही थी कि हमने हर आदमी को सेग्रीट करके बोलना कि हमें ड्राई और बेट, पर ड्राई और बेट का क्या कंसेप्ट है, क्योंकि हिंदुस्तान में शायद मेरे से ज्यादा ये स्वाति जानती है, कोई भी टेक्नोलॉजी वायबल नहीं है हिंदुस्तान में कि इस मिक्स वेस्ट को ट्रीट कर जाए। क्लीन हम कर रहे हैं, ये भी बहुत अच्छा एफर्ट कर रहे हैं, मैं देखा टाउन में भी झुंड में भी जाते हैं, पर दी एंड लेटर क्या हो रहा हो, डंपिंग साइड में जाके वो हमारे एचआरडी वर्कशॉप में वहां जाके वो वहां खड़ा हो जा रहा है। हमें पता है स्टेट में, मैं इस चीज को जानता हूँ, मेरे को पता कि 42-55% वो बीच में ट्रीटेड हो रहा है, ट्रीटेड इन द सेंस कि रिसाइकल हो रहा है। रिसाइकल जो हर आदमी बेच रहा है, कबाड़ी वाला बेच रहा है, जो हमारे रजिस्टर रैक पिक करे हैं, या कोई उसने दुकान खोली हुई है, पर जो 45 से रह गया वो कहाँ गया। और वेस्ट के लिए मतलब हमने इंस्पेक्टर यूज किया है, हमने यहाँ 6 लोकेशन में कंपोस्टिंग पिट बनाई है, जैसे आपने देखा होगा थोड़ा सा, पर उसको यूज नहीं कोई कर रहा, एमसीडी को मेंटेन नहीं कर रहा। मैं भी अपनी जैसे गुरुजी के मंदिर के नीचे जो एक डस्टबिन लगाया हुआ है उसके साथ कंपोस्टिंग पिट में जो बेट है, अब वहीं उसको एक धर्मकोड में बनाया हुआ, पर उसको कोई यूज नहीं कर रहा, मतलब जो भी है उसमें जस्ट। और मैं आपको बताऊं, मैं 2003 में यहाँ पॉइंट बोर्ड था, तो मेरे को इतना टीम में, मैं मेरी ये लाइन नहीं थी प्रोफेशनल, मैं थोड़ा मैकेनिकल लाइन का था। जब मैं आया इधर धर्मशाला में पॉइंट किया, तो उस टाइम मैं शायद टीएसओ काम करता था यहाँ। तो मतलब जब मैं मैक्लोडगंज में इंटर किया, तो ये एंट्री पॉइंट में इतना गार्बेज होता था, और सेकेंड पॉइंट जो बोस मेरे को लगता था, गुरु जी के मंदिर के सामने एक जो टॉयलेट है, मतलब बहुत, मतलब उस टाइम में तो हमारा जो जनरेशन भी कुछ नहीं था, 5 टन जनरेशन था एट प्रेजेंट ना, हम डेली जो है 15 टन जनरेशन है, उसको हम डंपिंग साइड तक 14 टन के आसपास ले जाते, बीच में लूप होते हैं। मतलब उस टाइम की मैं देखता हूँ कि आज कहाँ है, ये टिपा रोड चले जो आप, मैं लोकल की बात कर रहा हूँ, वैसे नहीं है मैं, मतलब यार टिपा टूवर्ड टिपा चले जाओ, ये थोरलिंगा है, थोरलिंगा आज भी वैसी ही है पर इम्प्रूव है उसमें, ये तो नंदी से, क्योंकि वो हैवी नहीं है। उन्होंने जैसे आपने बोला कि सोर्स सेग्रीगेशन, कोई भी टेक्नोलॉजी वाइबल नहीं है, क्योंकि जो मशीन ले आते हैं हम लोग, ले हमने, मैंने प्लाज्मा पायरोलिसिस के ऊपर काम किया, वो मशीन जो है वो ओनली पॉलीथिन के लिए, पॉलीथिन ठीक है, पॉलीथिन का ही इम्पैक्ट है कि आज के लिए बेच क्या पॉलीथिन, 55% जो है रिसाइकलेबल में तो बिक जा रहा है, कोई 40 रुपए किलो 25 किलो, पर एक सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक है, मींस के ये रैपर है, जैसे इसका रैपर है, ये रिसाइकल में हुआ है। जितने भी इसमें 45 कैटेगरीज के हैं वो नहीं रिसाइकल हो, तो उसका सोल्यूशन क्या है? मैंने एक यहाँ वर्ड डाला था फिरोड, शायद किसी ने देख पढ़ा होगा नहीं। वो ये होता क्या है, इस सिंगल प्लास्टिक को हम जैसा आप जब साउंडिंग में देखते हैं, इसको लोग जन बर्न कर देते हैं। उस बर्न पीछे, इसके बर्न के पीछे लॉजिक क्या है, ये क्या है, होता क्या है? जब इसको हम बर्न करते हैं तो इसमें दो चीजें निकलती हैं, एक होती है फिरोन और एक होती है डाइक्सन। फिरोन और डाइक्सन जिससे मस्टर्ड गैस भी बनती है, जो रशिया में एक इंसिडेंट हुआ था, मतलब T-19 के उसके बराबर, उसके बम के बराबर होती है। कर इसको हम बिलो 700 डिग्री से नीचे बिलो बर्न करेंगे, और भी ओपिनियन में ऑक्सीजन है, जब ऑक्सीजन इसमें क्लब होगी ये डाइक्सन और फिरोन में, और इतनी डेंजरस चीजें हैं ये, यही जाके ओजोन लेयर को आपको ब्रश करेंगी। जो क्लाइमेटल चेंज आ रहे हैं, लेटर ऑन आपने जुलाई में देखा होगा वहां बाक्सू में जो हुआ, ठीक है, और उसके बाद मिस मैंने जो उन्होंने जो ड्रेन बनाई हुई थी उसके ऊपर कचरा नहीं था, वो गाड़ियां थी वहां, एक्चुअली पार्किंग स्पेस नहीं है। उसने गाड़ी वो, क्योंकि मैं प्रैक्टिकल देख रहा हूँ, हमने वहां किया है, वो दो स्कूटरी थी वहां, उसने नाले में खड़ी कर दी थी, क्योंकि पार्किंग प्लेस नहीं, उसने कहाँ खड़ी कर दी है। वो जैसे उसके नीचे फंसा, एक बाइक था, जो दो मेजर कॉज थे वहां, वो जो उस बाइक फंसा और उससे जो आया और उसने सारा ही ब्रश कर दिया। तो ये क्या चीज है? और ये प्लास्टिक जो है, देखो इसको, ये 300 ईयर, ये साइंटिफिक को है 300 ईयर्स, अगर आप इसको जमीन में दबेंगे ये डिस्ट्रॉय नहीं होगा। बात तो हम करते हैं इस चीज को, अभी इस ये सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक है, और ये रोज के टाइम में हमारे एवरी होम में यूज हो रहा है। बच्चे चॉकलेट खाते हैं, रैपर है, सोल्यूशन कुछ नहीं है, टॉफी है, चॉकलेट है, दूध का वो है, चलो दूध का जो है ये थोड़ा अलग कैटेगरी है, रिसाइकल हो जाता है, इसको LD क्या बोलते हैं इसको, ये रिसाइकल हो जाता है, दो तीन वो है कैटेगरी। तो ये जो है, अभी हिमाचल गवर्नमेंट ने क्या किया है, हमने MCD में भी ये इनिशिएटिव लिया है, हमने चार जगह में एक सेंटर बनाया। उसमें क्या हो रहा है, जो सिंगल जो नहीं हो रहा, तो हमारा एक हिमाचल गवर्नमेंट से और MCD से अंबुजा सीमेंट फैक्ट्री में इसका एक MOU हुआ, तो हमने पास 8 मंथ में 60 मेट्रिक टन ओनली प्योर पॉलीथीन, उसमें और कोई गार्बेज नहीं, प्योर पॉलीथीन हमने उनको दिया, क्योंकि वहां क्या होता है इसमें बॉयलर में ये एज ए फ्यूल यूज होता है, मतलब जैसे फ्यूल में तो बॉयलर में क्या होता है कि कोयला यूज होता है, तो वो भी से निकलता है, तो वो भी इन्वायरमेंटल डिग्रेडेशन का सिस्टम है कि वहां से निकालेंगे, पेड़ काटेंगे या कुछ भी करेंगे, या ये बॉयलर हस्क है। तो ये गवर्नमेंट ने अच्छा सिस्टम किया, और ये हमारे जो अनऑर्गेनाइज सेक्टर में वो है रैक पिकर, मतलब जिनको हम सैलरी में नहीं रखते, तो उसको 70 रुपीज पर किलो MCDs को पे करेगा, मतलब उसकी लाइवलीहुड के लिए। तो हमने ये लोगों को यहाँ, मतलब लास्ट 8 मंथ में हमने 45 लाख जो है इनको बांटा इस चीज को। और वो लेटर वहां जाके क्या हो रहा है, वो जो रैक पिकर है वहां जाके नहीं सेग्रीगेशन हो पा रहा। देखो मैडम ने बोला बड़ा अच्छा टेट्रापैक, मैं बहुत एक हैरान हूँ, क्योंकि जो डंप यार्ड है, मैं डेली जाता हूँ वहाँ, क्योंकि मेरे को थोड़ा बहुत मेरी जॉब भी वहां से शुरू हुई, मैं डेली 1-2 घंटे जाता हूँ। मैं कई बार लोगों को पूछा, इनके से पहले भी थे, मेवांग करते थे इनके ऑफिस में, TSU में, वो बोला यार इसको इकट्ठा करो डॉक्टर, मतलब यार जा कहाँ है नहीं मैं उनको वाकई देख रहा, देखो ना मैं हमारा तो देखो ऐसा एक्सपीरियंस हो गया, हम तो गार्बेज पहचान लेते कि किस होटल से आया और कहाँ से आया और किसने फेंका,
तजुर्बा
ऐसा सिस्टम हो गया। मैंने यार ये टेट्रा पैक जा कहाँ रहे, और हमने इसके पीछे रिसर्च भी की कि खरीद रहा है तो कौन खरीद रहा है भाई, हमारे से भी ले जाए। फिर उसने मेहमान कर मेरे को बोला कोई सिंगापुर की कंपनी है जो कुछ, बोले यार ये ले जाओ, अच्छी बात है यहाँ हल्का होगा, और मेरा जो रैग पिकर मैंने वहां लगाया उसका इनकम जनरेट होगा। अच्छी चीजें, छोटी छोटी चीजें, मतलब जो देखने वाली है जो उसको, क्योंकि वहां जाएगा हमारे पास सब, और जो आग लगेगी तो उसमें तो फिर देखो लंग्स की प्रॉब्लम, और एमसीडी से लोग वैसे हिंदुस्तान का वाके खुश नहीं होते कहीं भी आप रिगार्डलेस जो है क्योंकि हमारी जो ड्यूटी है जस्ट हमने बोला कलेक्शन को हमारी ड्यूटी डेथ बर्थ से लेके डेथ तक मींस के एमसीडी में आज आपका जो बर्थ सर्टिफिकेट बच्चा फर्स्ट इसमें यूनिवर्सिटी में आया उसका बर्थ सर्टिफिकेट तो रजिस्टर कहाँ करेगा तो एमसीडी करेगा और उसके बाद जो डेथ है वो भी वहीं से तो ये मैडम जी ठीक है बहुत अच्छा मैं बहुत अच्छा लगा मेरे को ये अच्छी हमारे एक और संस्था की ओर है वो वाटर बॉडीज के ऊपर कर रही है काम वो भी अच्छा काम कर रही है जैसे बोला उसके वाटर स्केटी का वो भी हमारे साथ काम कर रही है वो तो
थैंक यू सो मच मिस्टर सुरेंद्र जैसे आपने कहा कि आपको हर तरह के चैलेंजेस सामने आते होंगे but in the afternoon session we'll be very happy to discuss more and we learn more about some of your initiatives as well as maybe share our ideas in how we can make it more effective so that Dharamshala benefits at the end. Thank you so much and okay next we have Mr. Ngawang Sonam is the environment coordinator at the Tibetan Settlement Office, the TSO that Sridhar just mentioned. The TSO office, he's been the environmental content coordinator since 2015. He's actually one of our locals here. He was born and brought up in Dharamshala itself. So he tells me that he finds it an honor to be able to give back to his town by serving in the environment desk. And this allows him to look after the overall waste management in the region of Upper Dharamshala, carried by the contractors, and acknowledge all the changing policies made by the municipal corporation. And to bring it to the public awareness as well. He feels it is his responsibility to take care of the environment and is deeply motivated by people who contribute to the protection of the environment. So I'd like to invite Ngawang Sonam to kindly come in.
Good morning, everyone. And myself, Ngawang Sonam, and I'm working at the Environmental Desk of Tibetan Settlement Office from June of 2015. And it's been 6.5 years as I working at the Tibetan Settlement Office as an environmental coordinator. So the thing that I want to highlight over here is, in the first place, why this environmental desk was like formed in the very our, you know, like you, whether you call it a welfare office or a Tibetan settlement office. Actually, the settlement office is the new name, which was changed back in 2014 after the rehabilitation policy of 2014 by the central government of India. So before it is called as the welfare office. So it's the same, same name, either you call it a welfare or a Tibetan settlement office. So the history behind formation of the Clean Upper Dharamshala program, it is that, as we all know, like our great leader, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, got Nobel Peace Prize back in 1989. And during those days, actually the place Dharamshala, Macleodganj, either we call the downtown Dharamshala or Macleodganj, which is we call upper Dharamshala, which is considered of three wards. And after the expansion of municipal corporation, right now it's, we have like ward number 4 and fifth ward is also considered in the upper region. So reason behind of the formation of the Clean Upper Dharamshala program in 1994. So after His Holiness the Dalai Lama was recognized as the Nobel Peace Laureate. So when His Holiness the Dalai Lama was received that award in Scandinavia country. So his most important message was universal responsibility and environmental protection. So during those days, late 80s and early 90s, Dharamshala was totally a very remote area, and it is covered by forest and few infrastructure buildings and like offices were there. Since His Holiness the Dalai Lama residence is over here, and our government in exile is also situated at the Gangi, which is situated at the ward number 4 right now. So that those days, actually, now it was the thing that when His Holiness the Dalai Lama and the government in exile shifted its permanent occupancy over here in Dharamsala, during those days in 1960s, 70s, there were not that much like trashes, and most of them were biodegradable one. And since the plastic manufacturing boomed up in India in the 80s, eventually this whole wrapping things, the plastics and, you know, single use, whether we call it single use plastic or anything, it started, ended up in, you know, in the hill stations as well. Since in hill stations, we have also small shops around there. So the reason behind formation, this was that now the whole international media was getting, knowing about this very small town, Dharamsala, since His Holiness was, just got the Nobel Peace Prize and his message was very strong regarding the environmental protection. Now the international media was questioning, because once they started coming over this small town, and they were saying, this place is, even though, now it's in the stage of like, now the garbages and the plastics are, accumulating all around the, Upper Dharamsala. So the general people, the local media and the international media was asking, like, His Holiness used to preach about environmental protection, but look at his own residence. It's filthy out there. The illegal dump site hotspots are everywhere. And due to that thing, even though we don't have a legal jurisdiction back then in early 90s and 80s also, and also this whole accumulation of garbage hotspots around the town started in the mid 80s and late 80s, then starting from 90s also. So that Bad and Welfare Office started its pilot project in 1992, even though it was not officially formed as a Clean Up a Dumpster program. That pilot project was reducing of the hotspots, even though back then municipal corporation was the sole responsibility and the contractors were there. But as we know, the work was not up to the mark, and as the town itself is, globalizing to the, whole local tourists and tourists as well. So in 1992, the pilot project was started as to reduce the illegal hotspots around the town. So for continuous 2 years, the welfare office was doing that very initiative to reduce the illegal dump sites that are accumulated around the town. And at the same time, environmental education program was initially started back in 1992 from the very household sectors to segregate their waste into dry waste, wet waste, because we had been started giving education back then in 1992. So as we are aware, in third world country, since right now the COP26 is happening at the Glasgow, actually we know that the very COP conference of the party was actually first launched in 1992 itself at the Rio de Janeiro. So as we are looking about the third world country who is now ready to getting aware of the recyclable programs and all these things, we were the first one who started, initiating this program in Upper Dharamsala, because we felt like we have those extra responsibilities, since this Dharamsala place is the Indo-Tibetan community area. Both Indian Tibetans and international tourists are living together over here. So despite of looking after the beneficiaries and all things, we felt more responsibility towards conserving the environment situations over here. So now, starting from 1994, the Clean Up Dharamsala was officially formed. So under that thing, we have two sections over here. First one is the green workers. Actually, green worker is a term which is referred to as an international term. We call it those who collect dry waste. Yeah. So, and that in those 1994, what we were doing, as we are looking at the, as the Dharamsala hall itself is situated at the hill stations, so there's definitely an infrastructure problem. So when we look at the European developed countries, each household, small or whether big, they had their bins, separated blue and green outside their residence, and small pickup vans, they take up these things. But over here, the infrastructure problem was that all the residents are, in a hill area. So we launched this green worker. Yeah, so they go door to door. And before the green worker started its operation, we had already given awareness environment to segregate their waste into dry waste and wet waste. Wet waste was very simple. because like as I was telling, in 1994 we had already started, we had already got two garbage trucks. One is for dry waste and one is for wet waste. Dry waste garbage truck always go with the green workers so that they have a less burden on their shoulders, because like they're carrying all the stuff from the residents. So that day, so what we have that in that very wet waste, all the household waste which are of non reusable, so that those were dumped in our wet waste, and like all the dry waste are just kept outside in a sack which we used to give to the all the residents in the upper Dhamsar region. So it was easier for green workers to just, you don't have to knock at their door, just outside their houses there's a sack of bag which is only consists of dry waste. So from there, and at the same time, we have a green workers, the recycled paper workshop. So those very, we have in 1994, we have a 12 green workers and a 12 recycled paper factory artisans. So what they do in a daytime, during the daytime, they go each residence to collect the dry waste and they bring it to our segregation center. From there, the segregation take place. But first and foremost, the first segregation take place inside our dry waste truck itself, back since from 1994, because like not all the dry waste are, you know, of a recyclable like goods. But yeah, so that thing. So we have a like team of green worker and a recyclable paper factory recycle workshop artisans working at the same thing. So coming from there, and we are very quite lucky that in this whole 27 years of service, we had almost 6 to 7 garbage disposal trucks solely donated by His Holiness the Dalai Lama Charitable Trust directly from there, because like those are the most kind of like funds that we had been receiving so far. So and until now, and at the moment, then you know, in 2000, after serving for 9 years voluntarily. As a humanitarian kind of program in this stuff. In year 2002, we were awarded a sanitation contract by the municipal corporation. Those days also, even though the fund that we received from the municipal was a very less amount, but the expenditure that we were giving, you know, and the service that we were providing to the local residents over here, despite of like any races or any tourists or anything, we are giving this service to all of the people. And our main motive was like, in this environmental kind of like issue and all this thing, everyone needs to contribute something, because when we are talking about developed countries, either you call it the European country or American, Northern America, not all the government sectors are only the one who is making a zero waste. From the households and institutions and organizations, they are all contributing in this program. So we felt like a refugee community over here, and by the grace of Indian government, we had this second home over here. And why don't we like give back them by our means of service, in the sense of like from the very low level or something. So this is what we are doing since from 2002 to 2015, we had been carrying out, despite of the funding problems, we had been carrying out this humanitarian program. But since the formation of a smart city and the municipal community council turned into corporations, from there, we were ineligible to participate in the local tenders. Since before the whole procedure of contracts were made under the agreement signs. So since the formation of a municipal corporation, all the sanitation tenders were given through the e-tender. So Clean Upper Dhamsala program is first and foremost, is not a registered organization. It's a unit undertaken by the settlement office, Tibetan Settlement Office, which falls under the Homes Department of the Central Tibetan Administration. So this is the phase that we become, we are not a now contractor, we are just giving our service as a voluntarily act. And at the moment, we have our composting site. Our composting project had been started since 2002, and we had our composting site right now, the one that is over here, it's at the TCV, Tibetan Children Village School near Dalek. And back then we have also a composting site at Central Tibetan Administration, Khangi itself. So talking about right now, also we give so many awareness programs, as you can see, in the school levels, and also like designing also tree plantation, doing awareness programs on the street levels and doing flash mobs. And these are the whole programs that we are doing. And at the moment, our truck is also, our garbage disposal truck is on a daily basis. It goes around the every street of the Upper Damsar region, taking all the trashes and minimizing the stress on the like government kind of like contractors and independent workers. So like, because as we, as I told, like each and every one has the responsibility towards like contribution, you know, contributing towards minimizing the whole situation. So this is what Clean Upper Damsar had been doing since 1992. And yeah, thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Kamala. So I'm sure the Tibetan Settlement Office and Kamala, your desk really faces a big challenge, because as we all know, most of the tourists are attracted to this Upper Dharamshala area. So along with them piles up all the garbage, the waste produced by their presence, as well as all the ones coming from the hotels. So thank you for your presentation. And now we have Mr. Mohinder Sharma. He's also born and brought up here in Dharamshala. Mohinder ji lives in a village called Rakkar, lower down in the valley. And this beautiful village is surrounded by rice fields in the summers and wheat fields in the winters. And Mohinder has been working as a project manager and environmentalist at NISHTA organization since 1998. NISHTA is a charitable trust working in the field of health, education, and environment in the surrounding area. They also work with single women, children education, and natural farming techniques. So it is very interesting to hear from you, Mohinder. Thank you. Yes, Mohinder.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, please play the video. So here I have a video, which is a 2-minute video. And on this panel discussion, most of the things have been already covered. So I would not repeat many things. I will try and make it. So this is how we do house to house collection. People collect.
Is it sound?
No sound. Yeah, people collect their waste segregated on the household. So our team goes and bring it. This is our collection segregation center. So every household has given NISTA bag. So they collect. Look, you can see it's all segregated and dry. There's no filth.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how our team goes. Every 15 days, a single house get visited, and then this all dry and clean plastic, which you can't do anything with, can as getting filled in these sacks. And we have a manual machine. We are trying to make the waste zero. We are not shifting the waste from one place to the other place. Mm-hmm. So we are making plastic blocks out of these all wrappers. This is only wrappers. All other solid plastic recyclable goes back to the recycling. And all these environment friends, they come and collect these. So it's very easy to work with the plastic when it's dry and clean.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question of segregation. That's it. As you saw in the video, NISTA is a charitable organization which started by an Austrian woman like 30 years back, and we get our registration in 1998. So from very beginning, I'm working with NISTA, and we were running a health center, and suddenly from the doctor desk, a thing came out that everybody in the village is getting scratching problem and a lot of diarrhea and so. So we try to find out why it's happening. So we checked the water resources. So they were all thrown garbage into that, and that was diluting, and it was then people were washing their clothes there, and then all these things. From there, the environment project starts. There was a reason to do it. Basically, we were the health center. We were never thinking to do a environmental work, but environment and health is related. So that's how it started. So because I was the only, there were five staffs, and I was the only young boy there. And for me to do something alone was difficult. So I formed a youth club in the village. So I collected every young people, even the girls and boys. And so youth club, it was very difficult on those days, 98, 2000, to bring girls out of the house and to involve them in something. So we started a stitching center and a computer center. So we give them some sort of the families that their children are going to learn something. And from there, we started all these other projects, getting them involved into environmental activities and so. So we start cleanups, and then we end up with the plastic. What to do? Collecting is one. You can collect it. You can involve school children. You can use. You can then you have a heap of plastic. What will you do with it? And we tried in segregating it. Given some was given to Kawaris, and then for years we were sitting on this heap of plastic, and suddenly thing came that PWD is taking the plastic. So then it boosted us. We did a lot of cleanups and collected a truck of dry and clean plastic. It was all dry and clean. This was our focus from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. And we brought this truck to Churan. I went there and talked. There was a set of then we shifted this truck there, and I have a receipt that I have deposited this truck. Mm-hmm. PWD, they will use it in the roads. And we thought, okay, they are doing it. But then later we found out nothing happened, and one day it got all burned, produced all dioxin and ferrosin. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This happened, this happened.
Yeah. So it was very disappointing. It was very, very disappointing. And all these young people who were very, it was very difficult for me to bring them back, give them again energy to. Then we decided, we started in 2000, all environment project. Then we decided to put bins, because people were either burning the plastic or throwing it on the, that's how everywhere were happening. And then we very proudly put bins in the villages. And people were putting their plastic into the bins, but it was everything. So then the problem was how to handle it. So after 2 years, we remove all the bins, which government is now installing the bins. We have done it 20 years back. So bin was not a solution, because so we removed bin, and we started a project which is awareness and education. We went every household. Now we have 400 households. We went each and every household. We talked to an old person, a woman, or a child by using many tools, religious tools, scientific tools. Yeah. So now we are in a situation where every household has a Nista bag, a printed Nista bag. We give every household a bag. Mm-hmm. And then they supposed to segregate their waste then and there, and put only the soft plastic, which you can't do anything with, into these bags. Then our team goes every 15 days, even the shops, and bring it. And as you saw in the video, we make blocks out of it. Then we construct. We use it in the construction. You can use car garages. You can use storerooms. You can make sitting platforms. We have done many these kind of things in our village. And even now some people are using it in constructions, like you have sink slabs and sinks where you need a filling material. Mm-hmm. People are buying it. We are selling it 20 rupee, 18 by 18. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the whole idea was to make people aware and educated. So then we went to the houses, and in few houses people were the bags were mixed filled. So we did, we started doing educational kind of a thing then and there. Bag, this, we need this, we don't need. You can do, you can give it to the buffalo. This can, paper, you can also put it under the tree. It will go back and feed back the tree. So that's how we reduced it to 40%. So the amount of waste what we are getting is very less now. And even the children of our village are bringing their waste after their school, because we have after school programs at NISTA, like in computer education, library, things like that. So they bring their garbage to our site, and in return, they will find some reward, piece of food, or anything, or chocolate. And we are doing many programs with other schools around, like Sulet, Godan, Kadota, up on the hills, like mobile libraries. Yeah, so they are also bringing it there, and that's how we are concluding it. We are making the base zero. For us, the conclusion is, for us is, education is the key, and the segregation is the key. When that will happen, you can handle the waste very easy, and one should work for that. Shifting is not a solution.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mohinder. And as you were saying, awareness and education really is the key, because we can see a huge difference when we visit the Rakkar area, your village. Just by the look at it, you know, the amount of garbage that's on the streets is as compared to other villages. You can really, really make, see. And after, when you really educate people about segregation, you see, as in Rakkar, it is implemented, and also in, I think, because of the TSO, also in the library area, people are already segregating it before they are disposing it. So thank you very much. Now, our panel here present in Dharamshala have all spoken, and I'm very excited to welcome Swati Ji to this discussion as our resource person. So let me introduce her a little bit. Swati Singh Sambial, she is a circular economy and waste management expert with over 11 years of experience in South Asia and Global South. Swati has done city-scale implementation projects in India and has worked in Zanzibar, in Tanzania, Eswatini, Ethiopia, Ghana, and Namibia in bringing policy and implementation reforms and pushing the integrated waste management approaches. She has worked extensively with governments and environmental regulatory agencies of Bhutan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh on projects related to environmental compliance, impact assessment, waste and water, wastewater management. She has worked as the head of a program on municipal solid waste at New Delhi-based environmental policy and advocacy think tank, Center for Science and Environment, CSE, for the past 9 years, And now at present, she's affiliated as a waste management specialist at UN Habitat since 2001. So Swati, we are all looking forward to hear you. Thank you for joining us.
Okay, yeah, so sorry. There's always some technical glitch before starting. So thank you so much, Sonam, and to all my fellow friends and community at TCCR and all the other presentees. It was very insightful to hear all the presentations and also to sort of know and get updated on the kind of work that is happening around waste management in Dharamshala. And really some wonderful initiatives, some wonderful individual initiatives, some wonderful initiatives by organizations. And also to the corporation, you know, a big thanks for being very forthcoming and for being very open about the challenges that you face. Because itna asaan nahi hai ek aise shahar ka kachra prabandhan karna जहाँ पे ऑफ कोर्स इट्स हिली बट देन इट्स ऑल्सो अ टूरिज्म यू नो वेरी हाई ऑन टूरिस्ट डेंसिटी एंड पीपल फुटफॉल. So it's a very challenging city to sort of manage. And thanks to Sonam and the team at TCCR for getting such wonderful speakers at such a short notice of time, you know, collating all of us. I'll keep my focus on, you know, some of the discussions that previous speakers have already shared and probably some of the solutions that you could think about for Dharamshala as a city. I think 4 or 5 years back, we were majorly talking about waste management. But today, as we all are sitting, we are talking about circular economy. We are talking about zero waste cities. There's a global momentum to have zero waste cities worldwide. And in India, I feel very fortunate that we have some success stories around zero waste and circular economy. And since Dharamshala already is on a path, you know, to sort of not only host these discussions, but also sort of, you know, all of you sitting together and thinking and planning something for the city. So I think you're really on the right path. And of course, for any such intervention, it needs a cumulative effect. It needs a group effort and different stakeholders have to come together. As I said previously, it's not just municipality's job to keep your city clean. It's not just municipality's job to keep the environment clean. We all collectively have to play an important role to ensure that, you know, we have a sustainable city for our future generations. So, of course, you know, there has been data that has been shared already. But, you know, I'll just sort of talk briefly on the issues that we've had. So if we talk about all our cities, you know, I think we all have gone through a very difficult time. Past 2 years have not been easy. The last I met with folks from TCCR was in Dharamshala and there was a training and, you know, we all could physically meet and discuss certain issues. But look at how we have adapted ourselves to the challenge that was posed to us past 2 years, which was the pandemic. And a lot of what has happened in some sense is related to environment, is related to the way we used to lead our lives. And I think it's very right to say that this is our new normal, you know, that I'm sitting in Delhi and some folk is sitting somewhere, but we are still collectively together. It's also less resource, you know, it's also more resource efficient because I'm not flying down to Dharamshala to do, to sort of take this session. All of us are in our comfortable spaces but are still able to sort of share what we want to or have come together for a collective cause. So I think if we are able to adjust to the new normal, it would be right to say that it's about time that we do things and we take steps collectively or individually to have better impact on the environment and to do things that are rightful, that are more resource intensive. So yeah, I mean, I think in a nutshell, our cities, if we talk about municipal waste, and one challenge which no one really talked about, I was hoping that someone addresses it. We all have seen an increased use of plastics and quantities of PPEs that increased in past 2 years. It still is quite high. Municipalities past 2 years were quite overburdened with the kind of waste that they were already dealing with, but with a new type of waste that was coming. So of course, past 2 years and the pandemic has burdened the municipal system. And we need better solutions and more proactive approaches to come out of it. We can't just say that, well, we have to strengthen collection or strengthen infrastructure. It has to be a multifold approach. Now, why hill cities in particular are a challenge? I may talk in some sense about Dharamshala, but you know, across India, we say we are quite fortunate that at least we have solid waste management rules that specifically address the component of effective management in hilly and mountain areas. Considering the fact that about 29% of the country is hilly or mountainous. So of course, there has to be a focus in having effective waste and resource management in hill cities. And also for the fact that mountainous cities are, you know, quite eco-sensitive. They are fragile. There is always dearth of infrastructure. There's dearth of land, resources, or, you know, poor institutional and financial capacities to look into. So, are you able to hear me? I just got a message that there's some internet error. Am I audible to everyone? Sona? Just wanted to check, am I...
Hi Swati, we just lost connection for a bit. Can you hear me?
Yes. So, Sona, just bug me if... just ping me if there's any issue with connect. Hello? Am I audible now, Sona?
Swati, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. I can hear you. Yeah.
Kimbala, speaker.
No, listen.
Later, Leshara. Swati.
Yeah, Sonam, I can hear you. Sonam, you're on mute.
Sorry, Swati, we just lost connection for a little while. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
She's speaking continuously.
I can hear you, Sona. I can hear you. Can you hear me, Sona?
Hi, Swati. We can hear you now.
Okay.
Yes, we can. Yeah.
Should I continue?
Yeah, thank you.
Should I continue?
Yes, you can continue.
Okay. I'm so sorry.
Swati, actually, the main computer is not connected yet, but I think it'll take only a few seconds.
So should we wait?
Can you just wait like 2 seconds?
Yeah, I can. Just give me a heads up.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, Swati, it seems the connection is back on. So, whenever you're ready, thank you. Swati, you're muted.
All right. So, did you all miss me entirely, or should we restart again? Sonam, can you give me a heads up?
Yes, Swati. You can continue from this page.
Okay. So, I was sharing, and I'm sorry for the lag that happened. You know, the hill cities are really important, and the Indian Himalayan region is imperative because it covers about 29% of the country. And if we look into the available data, in totem, the Indian Himalayan region comprising of Himachal and other states, it generates about 22,372 tons of municipal solid waste every day, which is about 8.1 million tons annually. It's a very significant number. Also, I looked into a few data, and if you look into the tourist arrivals, you know, it has drastically increased over the years, also to about 60% in past 4 years. So it increased from 84.2 million in 2011 to 136.1 million in 2015. And who knows, these were the last estimates, but it could be even more. And if we look into the total population of the Indian Himalayan region, it's about 60 million. Now, what are some of the issues, you know, that are sort of centric to Dharamshala? There was last a study done by World Bank, and it's revealed that some aspects of the town were rated very negatively. For instance, hygiene and waste, poor transportation and communication. But it's not just specific to Dharamshala. You know, even if we look across hill cities, be it Shimla, Darjeeling, Srinagar, Nainital, Kohima, there are decent waste collection services, but the collected waste is dumped in open areas, including in forests, thus creating huge issues. Now, some of the key findings that probably are common to all hill cities. One is that plastic is probably a crucial waste that is generated in the areas, both from households, commercial, as well as tourist-related areas. Segregation is not commonly practiced, as the person from Municipal Corporation Dharamshala very significantly highlighted, ki agar hum segregate nahi karenge, to aap koi bhi technology apply kar dijiye, it will not work. You know, so it's a myth that if you don't segregate, you will be able to treat waste. You cannot treat or manage waste if you are not segregating. So segregation is a bit of an issue across hill cities in Himachal Pradesh. Biodegradable waste in villages probably can be used as animal feed or composted. Not a big issue, but dry waste is a major problem. Collection coverage is a challenge, of course, due to the topography and lack of efficient systems for collection across hill cities. And many households don't have a proper door-to-door collection system. It may exist in Dharamshala now, but still there are remote areas and remote places which you cannot reach or cover under a door-to-door collection scheme. So people, as a shortcut, they tend to dispose their waste by burning or throwing waste into drains. And waste is generally disposed of in valleys and waterways. I'm from Palampur, and I remember I was there about 3 weeks back for about 10 days. And it is quite shocking for me to see the development in Palampur. As a child who used to come for summer holidays because I used to study away, to a grown-up who now visits, you know, my home there, and the kind of construction that has happened. So earlier, the house we had in Palampur, it had a backyard which was forest. But now that backyard has converted into a field, or the other spaces in surrounding that house, which was really beautiful and had a nice view of the Dauladars, is now totally under, you know, is like constructed. And it's not a beautiful sight to see the level of development that's happening in hill cities, which also means a lot of construction and demolition waste. And I want to ask, what is happening to it? Then, of course, there is a willingness to pay user fee for solid waste management services. But are we collecting user fee? So I think our municipality is becoming income or wealth generating. And litter and garbage on trails is a very common issue. If you walk down from McLeodganj towards the church, you'll see a lot of dumping spots that are prominent and visible to tourists and to commoners. And then awareness of waste management. I think there is, hearing to all your discussions, I felt there is enough awareness. There has been a lot of awareness drives and initiatives that have been undertaken. But what lacks is that whether that awareness got transformed to behavior change. So whether all of you as organizations or NGOs or as individuals, did you back check that if you did these awareness programs, did it lead to behavior change? So I think the missing link that we often don't stitch is that while we are conducting awareness drives and while we are educating people, making them aware about segregation and better waste management and why they should give segregated waste, are we even notifying that this awareness is getting converted to behavior change? We often miss that element. So I would request, you know, all the presentees to do back check, be it Waste Warriors, be it other institutions, on awareness getting converted to behavior change. You know, it's a key element. You can't do much if you don't engineer people, you know, or to sort of change their existing behavior for better waste management in cities. If we look at waste composition for cities in Himachal Pradesh, and this is I've taken from the Department of Urban Development data of 2017. I'm assuming the numbers would be much higher. But of course, if I look at the numbers, it says that biodegradable fraction is about 50%. But the dry waste fraction is significantly high as compared to other cities. Plastic, 2017 ka data kehta hai ki plastic is 10%. But I'm assuming it's somewhere between 15 to 16% right now. Because after COVID, most of the cities have reported an increase in plastics. And of course, this data has not been analyzed or it has not been inventorized. But yeah, I mean, you know, plastic generation has significantly increased after the pandemic. So, of course, for Dharamshala as a city, what options we have? One is to shift to zero waste communities, have robust recovery infrastructure, have better incentives, have more empowered citizens, have effective waste reduction policies. And this is probably is the real hierarchy that the city should follow. One, of course, is the approach towards minimization. We often talk about waste management, but we never talk about minimizing our consumption, minimizing our footprint, in being happy in less, in having a zero waste approach towards living, or in having a minimal footprint. Because by adopting that, we'll not only benefit ourselves, but will, you know, benefit the cities we live in, the surroundings we live in. So, of course, number one is to have an approach which is bent towards rethinking, redesigning, reinventing waste management. So can Dharamshala as a city collectively sit together, you all as stakeholders, and do that? Then, of course, reducing and reusing, preparation for reuse. How do we want to reuse our resources? Do we want to go in for some upcycling interventions? Because presently, whatever we are doing in the name of recycling, it's downcycling. It's not even recycling. And then, of course, landfilling and incineration and all other treatment processes, they are the last rung of the ladder. But if we really want the city to approach, to follow a zero waste circular approach, then this is the hierarchy chart that we all must follow. And the city should remain somewhere between the steps 1 to 4 to be called as a sustainable zero waste city. So can we all reinvent waste management in Dharamshala is the question I'm asking all of you, or leaving all of you with this question. Now, how can we do it? One, of course, is to have a framework of solutions. We have to clearly look together at an integrated approach. We'll have to have sources of waste generation mapped, which means that we really need to know what is our waste in the city. You may have some old inventorization studies and composition analysis, but have we done some recent surveys? And there are some tools and methodologies that have been developed with which, if you use it, you can get to know the composition in say a week's time. And then it's important to sort of look into the seasonality because hill cities are sort of fragile. The rainfall is quite high, or other issues are, you know, quite rampant. And then having a clear idea on what is the amount of waste that is being generated by tourism, keeping an account of it, and how do we manage it? Have we made plans for managing of management of tourism-based waste, which means not only creating systems, but creating end-to-end systems and also making tourists aware. If you go to Bhutan, there is something called a tourism tax, which everyone has to pay. It is about $250 a day for any foreign national. For SAARC nations, it is somewhere about $50 to $100. And I think that fee is taken in order to maintain the carrying capacity of the country, which only has a population of 6 lakh, but also to maintain the beauty of the country, which is predominantly 75% forest. So we need to look into some of these innovative approaches for Himachal as well, for Dharamshala as well, which are touristically, religiously very, very important, but then they are also very, very fragile, you know, in terms of where they are placed and topography-wise. Some of broad recommendations that, you know, some of you can take. One, of course, is institutions, financing, and stakeholders. Any intervention that we do on the ground, it will not happen without getting local stakeholders together, but also getting some stakeholders that have experience in this area, or for that matter, getting funding and financing, you know, for projects in the city. So one, of course, is have robust local level policies or bylaws in place that reflect cities' approach towards zero waste. Secondly, operationalize capacities, something which we all are doing right now, that we're developing and sharing and exchanging knowledge and information and best practices. Third, involve local communities, involve NGOs, local groups, volunteers, and create systemic opportunities to get these different diverse stakeholders together. Also try to increase private participation. You know, can we explore CSR funds? Can we explore some private party funds to set up a driveway system or to set up some small pilot intervention? And then can we together work with corporation to replicate it? Then fifth, how do we integrate informal sector? There are various ways of doing it, but how can we sit together and think of approaches to integrate informal sector? Second and very important is data availability and awareness of SWM issues. So as I said, we need to have data-enabled decision-making in our cities, which means you can't plan without data, you can't strategize without data, you can't implement without data. And bad data leads to bad actions. It's very, very important from my experience and work on the field. So we really need to have the right numbers in place. On the basis of what figures are we planning this intervention? What are the quantities that we plan to resolve? And of course, creating awareness. As I said, without your awareness getting converted to behavior change, nothing will happen. It'll be like, you can create systems, you can create infrastructure, you can spend crores of money, but if you don't change behavior, you're back to zero. Third, waste generation and segregation. So of course, this all of you said, and I'll not repeat again, that source segregation has to be mandated and there has to be enough awareness on it. And then how do we involve local stakeholders to ensure that we create social entrepreneurship models, wherein some of you get jobs, some of you become local entrepreneurs and get into waste businesses. I think that also helps the city a lot to resolve the issue around waste management. And then, of course, create effective infrastructure for improving waste collection systems. This, I'm sure all of us know, and I'm not repeating it, but having a robust infrastructure in place. And of course, this you can see if your city has the bandwidth to invest in good infrastructure, material recovery facilities, storage centers, resource recovery centers, please go ahead and do that. But if you don't have that bandwidth, there are also very sustainable options and low cost methods and best case studies being implemented in India only, where a lot of cost was not spent on waste management interventions. So I think this is like an open field. If you have the bandwidth to invest into effective resource recovery options, go ahead, do that. But if you don't have, explore some of the best practices which some cities have done with very low cost interventions. We have examples of Alappuzha in Kerala, Trivandrum, Ambikapur in Chhattisgarh, Panchgani in Maharashtra, Gangtok in Sikkim, and some of them are actually hill cities that were able to, you know, have low cost infrastructure on waste management, but yet have successful solutions. So what could be the roadmap for resource recovery? Of course, I would have loved to be there in person and talk about some of these interventions, but one, as I said, it's very important to have data inventorization and assessment. So UN Habitat has developed this tool, which is called the Waste by Cities tool, which basically is a tool that helps cities to map waste flows. So if you apply this tool, and of course, I can share this booklet with Sonam. It takes about 8 days to apply this tool on the ground. And based on the application, you get the entire waste flow of the city. So I was in Mangaluru in April at the peak of the pandemic, conducting this survey for with my team, where we were trying to understand what is the existing resource recovery chain in Mangaluru. And based on that, now we are working with the municipal corporation to develop some circular interventions, also to get some circular investments for the city. And the city just had generation data and they had some very basic data on how much waste gets disposed. But by applying this tool, we were able to map what is the entire resource recovery value chain of the city, that they are only recovering 24% of the waste that they collect and rest of it still gets disposed. And the city really has to ramp up on circular interventions to ensure that a lot of these resources get recycled, get processed, get treated. So that's why data inventorization is important. I think you should just know for sure, and based on the experience that I've had, that bad data leads to bad planning and bad implementation. So having the right data for your city is very important. I can share this tool with the municipality and with Sonam. Please go through it. I can also share a tutorial that will help you to conduct this study in Dharamshala. And I if possible, and if we could collaborate, our team could even assist in doing this in Dharamshala. But of course, we'll have to explore that. And what gets generated based on the application of this tool? One is that, as you can see, you get to know what are the different areas, you know, waste generated across income groups in city. So what is the characterization of a waste in low income group areas, in middle income group areas, or in high income group areas? What is the average MSW composition? And the tool also identifies the leakages. So if you look at this picture, for Mangaluru, the leakage was about 4.1 kg per person per annum. So every person individually per annum was contributing to about 4.1 kg of plastics, which was quite high for the city. So the tool not only helps you in estimating the numbers or the entire resource recovery value chain of the city, but also gives you a detailed composition, also estimates leakage. So if you'll try to apply it in Dharamshala, you'll probably get to know how much is your leakages into water environment, into land environment, and how is it impacting at various levels and steps. Second, as I said, we need to mainstream segregation. There are ample examples of cities that you can explore and read about on mainstreaming segregation. Do we need to give incentives for segregation? I'm not sure. We should explore that. I feel we are in the sixth year after the Solid Waste Management Rules 2016 came. And now I feel segregation should be mandatory. It cannot be optional. So I think this is a request to the Municipal Corporation of Dharamshala to ensure that their bylaws are robust. They are up to date with the SWM rules 2016. And they explicitly say that if you don't segregate, you'll have to, give penalty. So I feel we are, we've reached a time where we need to have strict penalties for non-segregation. And of course, there have been various examples. For instance, Wengula is a small town in Maharashtra where people segregate into 27 different components. Panji is one wherein we here talk about three-way segregation or two-way segregation. But this city in Goa has been segregating since decades into a five-way segregation model. Or Panchgani in Maharashtra, which is again a hill city, but how it has created robust systems to ensure segregation at source. Another campaign which can be explored is this Shop With Your Waste campaign. And this is basically in order to incentivize recycling. This campaign was launched in Panji, and now a lot of areas in rural Goa and other municipalities in Goa are exploring with this. It's very simple. Households are given a list that they have to segregate their dry waste into 12, 13 items. And so if you see milk pouches, are kept separately. PET bottles are kept separately. Cardboards and Tetra Pak is stored separately. And there are some designated grocery stores. So if I'm a household, Sonam is a grocery store. So I can go to Sonam, give her my dry waste. And in exchange of that dry waste, Sonam, who's a grocery store owner, can give me a coupon, which is basically a money coupon and with which I can buy some grocery items. And in return, the grocery owner or Sonam here is linked to a dry waste recycler who gets clean dry waste from Sonam. And also in return, Sonam gets paid 1 or 2 rupees for giving that clean dry waste to the recycler. So it's a win-win situation for everyone. For the resident, which is me, that I separate my waste, I keep it segregated, and I get incentive for it, which is a monetary coupon for giving it to the grocery store. For Sonam, which is a grocery store, the incentive is that she'll get the money from the dry waste recycler or person. Because she's giving clean dry waste to the recycler. And for the recycler, it's a win-win situation because earlier he's linked to aggregators and rag pickers, but now he gets clean dry waste from the grocery stores itself. So I think something like that, I mean, it's quite innovative and it is successful in Goa. But again, it's only one state that is doing it and a few Panji city is exploring with it. Some of villages in rural Goa are exploring with it. And it has received rave reviews. But the thing is, we really need to sort of upscale on these innovative ideas and concepts. So will Dharamshala will be open to doing something like this or experimenting with this probably in just one ward and linking that one ward to probably a few grocery stores and see if it works or not. So I think another suggestion is that it's also important to explore that what will work for your city or not, because there'll be numerous case studies and examples, but you'll have to check. You can't adopt such an initiative for whole of the city, but you can definitely explore if it works for one ward. And if it works well, you can ensure that you can replicate it, say, in the main central market in McLeodganj area or in a commercial area. And if it works further, then you further upscale it. So I think that trial and error and, trial, hit and trial model, that has to be done for various waste and resource related interventions. I'll not dwell here. Of course, the person from Municipal Corporation Dharamshala highlighted the need for having good collection systems. And I'm aware Dharamshala has done some work around this area. But I think it's very much important to set up end-to-end systems to support segregation. That is very important. Many a times, waste management practices in our cities fail because we educate citizens to segregate, and then we get infrastructure. We get these big tippers, and then we create these transfer stations. But meanwhile, we forget that to collect segregated waste, we also need infrastructure that has those partitions We also need MRF facilities or aggregation centers or secondary transport points that have those partitions. So it's very important to create infrastructure that supports segregation end to end, all the way from collection to disposal. Some of the interventions that you can look into is Vijayawada city's technology. You know, they've created this integrated platform that not only tracks a collection of segregated waste, but you can track the entire flow of waste to different processing centers. And at any time, the municipality can review it. It can review non-compliance, it can review defaulters, and they also have a very active grievance call center. So if probably the waste at your doorstep is not collected, you are sort of connected via this application to a system of the corporation where you can complain or report. So I think at this hour, and if, Dharamshala is also one of the smart cities, if you can look into investing in some tracking systems and infrastructure so that you get to know about the flow of your waste or the channelization of the waste, it really helps in day-to-day monitoring. Because for corporation, how many times will your staff will be able to travel from point A to point B, considering it's a hill city and it has its own set of challenges? Sometimes it'll be raining there, or sometimes it'll be, snowing there, or sometimes, it's just not feasible. So can the city, as the smart city, invest into these AI-centric infrastructure or systems or software that help in tracking of waste? Coming to resource recovery interventions, and some of you in your presentations shared that you're sorting waste and you're making eco bricks and other products out of it. So I think what's really important is to create decentralized infrastructure, because it's more effective, it's more wealth and job generating. And when you plan decentralized infrastructure for a city, your costs also cut down, because a lot of your CNT, your collection and transportation costs, will be reduced if you have decentralized infrastructure over having one point in the city where all of your waste goes. Now, Dharamshala, in terms of size, is big. You have commercial area, you have residential area, you have McLeodganj area, so it's sort of sparse, but it's also wide. So I think it'll be good to have probably some 3 or 4 decentralized resource recovery centers or facilities where dry waste can come and it can further get channelized for recycling. You can also link, to private companies who would be quite keen to work with Dharamshala Municipal Corporation and collect dry waste to meet their EPR targets. So I think it's important to explore those options also. Also options where social entrepreneurship models can be explored, or where social enterprises are explored, where women, communities, local NGOs can sort of work together. If you're looking into wet waste management, it's important to have market linkages for compost or for biogas. So what will you do if compost is made? One option is that, can the corporation arrange a system to pick up compost from these centers and give coupons to, say, households that are composting? Because it's a common question that everyone asks, that, well, what if I compost and I start composting, but I only need a handful, I only have 4 pots, so what will I do of the excess compost? And everyone is usually clueless. So Vadodara in Gujarat has sort of found a solution to it, where municipality has a doorstep compost collection service. So if I have excess compost, the corporation person they have some allotted contractors, they'll come to my house and they'll pick compost and they'll give me a coupon with which I can go to a milk booth and buy whatever grocery items I want to. Something that is quite new but is being explored in Bangalore is compost as a service. I heard someone here wherein you have developed bioenzyme. And I think you could explore it because Compost as a Service basically is a concept where if I am the consultant, basically for households that want to compost at source, but don't want to get into composting. It means if Sonam is a household, I'm sorry, I'm only taking Sonam's name. I need some other names, but let's say Sonam is a household and she wants to compost, but she not wants to dirty her hands. So under this, a private company person will come to your doorstep, will pick up your kitchen waste, will set up a composter at the backyard or balcony of your house, and he or she will take care of it for 30 days. And for that, Sonam will have to pay this service provider only 150 to 200 rupees a month. So this is being explored in Bangalore for flats wherein people don't have the bandwidth or don't have time to take care of their wet waste, but they still want to have a greener life, a minimalistic life. And you know, so I think for that presentation on bioenzymes, do you want to explore something like that? And I think another thing that the municipal corporation can provide, Dharamshala Municipal Corporation, is that can you jot down a list of vendors and service providers for your city who are there? Many a times we don't have this data available for our cities. For instance, I am living in Dharamshala and I want to set up a composter at my house, or I want a biogas plant, or I want to contact someone who can take my dry waste so that I don't burn it. Or if I'm a shop owner and I have a lot of dry waste after Diwali, who do I give it to? So can the city jot down a list of vendors and technologies that are there or service providers in the city and make it available to everyone? You can put it on your website. You can print it on in the local newspaper so that, you know, people who want to do it can do it, or people who don't know who to approach. Because many a times you hear this from residents that, well, we want to do something, but we don't know how. So that how element is addressed. So maybe TCCR could help jotting down this list, or Waste Warriors could help jotting down this list, and the municipal corporation can publish it. I think this approach has been followed in many cities in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and it's very, very helpful for residents and communities who really want to do something on their own, and they have the bandwidth also, but they don't know who to approach to. I'll just skip this part, but basically I'll share the presentation with Sonam. It talks about which technologies we must not follow, especially from a hill city angle. So of course, waste to energy is quite futile for Dharamshala, considering that it is a eco-sensitive, fragile area. And, you know, incineration is only feasible if probably you're taking in the waste of 5-10 cities. But for only one city and with the amount of waste that Dharamshala generates, it's not a feasible option. So please don't ever go for incineration. I was earlier on the committee constituted by the state government of Himachal Pradesh. And I remember there was this incineration plant coming in Mandi, we did share all this logic as committee members that Himachal of all states shouldn't have waste to energy or incineration plants. Composting is something that the city can explore. There's a huge potential for composting. There's also a policy on promotion of city compost that was notified. Composting can definitely be explored. Biogas can definitely be explored. And of course, we as cities can't afford to have landfills. So if Dharamshala is thinking of having a dump site, I'm assuming not, but we really need to have no landfill cities or create infrastructure and setups so that we're not dependent on land. So these are some of the options, some of the instruments. So this is like a regular pot composter. Even a layman can make it. I just showed it to my house help, and she does it. Then pipe composting is nothing but a modification of your PVR pipe. This is a portable biogas plant. So I feel as we're sitting right now in 2021, November, almost moving to 2022, there are not two or three options for wet waste management. There are numerous options. Whatever works for you, please adopt it And I think the corporation can educate people to treat dry waste at source. Because if people learn to manage dry waste at source, the headache of the municipality to manage other components of waste automatically reduces. So can we have awareness campaigns around wet waste management, educating people to do composting at source, educating people to or shops to collectively bring and install biogas plants, or hotels in the city will have enough bandwidth and money to invest into biogas plants. So can the corporation sort of, enforce all these green options for wet waste management? And then I think we've talked enough about engagement and awareness, so I'll skip that part. Again, integration of informal sector is critical. I was looking at some of the cues from previous presentees on how can you explore integration of informal sector. But one, of course, is integration with municipalities. Other option could be, having solid waste management bylaws for Dhamshala, which clearly says that recyclable dry waste, the ownership will be to waste pickers, and then sort of linking them to resource recovery centers. A lot of cities in South have done this. Secondly, converting informal groups into enterprises or into SMEs or into self-help groups or social enterprises. So Ambikapur has explored it quite successfully. And third is training them, educating them so that they could be incorporated into resource recovery facilities as contractual staff. So I think amongst these three options, whatever works for the city, please adopt it. But yeah, really important and pertinent to integrate informal sector. I'm just leaving with a few examples of Ambikapur, probably the only city which has a 447 women-led self-help group that not only looks into collection of segregated waste, but also getting these waste to 17 decentralized centers and sorting it into not 30, 40, 50, but 150 different components. And it's a zero waste city. But again, it's a small city based in the middle of forest in Chhattisgarh. But when you go there, these are some of my pictures from 2019 when I was there for a survey. And then later on after pandemic, I asked the corporation, like, how are your women folk managing? Are they still going to collect? And they were like, yeah, we have given them PPEs and they're doing it very well. So these are some of those pictures during the time of the pandemic. But there are cities which have, and Ambikapur is one, which have upgraded the skills of local people to create models that are wealth generating, that are low cost, that are affordable, and that don't have cross of infrastructure. They've only provided the entire linkage to ensure that waste becomes product, becomes revenue, and everyone is happy. And then of course I talked about Panchgani. It's a small hill city which has worked hard to become a zero waste city. So it has about 17 wards where the level of segregation is not 90%, but 100%. Door-to-door collection efficiency is 100%. And again, the major work that they did, it was an integrative approach that was adopted, which was to educate, make people aware, change their behavior through workshop, through penalties, and through fines. And then, of course, there's this Swachh model in Pune, which is quite famous, wherein informal waste pickers are integrated and they work and support Pune Municipal Corporation to collect waste, segregated waste from households. They take it to material recovery centers, sort it into different components, which further goes to scrap markets and recycling units. And the households pay user fee, which in turn is paid to these informal workers as monthly fees. So again, PMC or the Pune Municipal Corporation not interferes with this system at all. And it's again a very wealth generating system because it's decentralized, it supports local workforce and communities, and it again supports Pune Municipal Corporation in a bigger way. So you know, over the years, of course, there has been a lot of wealth generation and reduction in expenditure on solid waste management by Pune Municipal Corporation by adopting this approach. So again, one other model that you could study. And this I talked about, which is my last step, I close from here, which is to have policy in place that reflects circular economy and resource efficiency. So Himachal Pradesh could explore having a policy on circular economy and resource efficiency. Goa State has that, State of Odisha has that. And then even locally, cities can have bylaws that reflect the zero waste concept. Because if it's not stitched down to your policy, probably one proactive administrator or commissioner or staff will do it. But when the baton will be passed on to the next, it may falter. So to cement a best practice, stitching it with a robust bylaw is very, very important. So I think I'm done with most of my suggestions and inputs. And I'm sorry, Sonam, if I've taken a lot of your time, but that would be all from my side. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Swati. Thank you very much, Swati, for this resourceful talk. And there are so many things that we can learn from what you have shared. You have shared with us new ideas based on how these plans have been implemented in other cities so that we can learn from them, and also about what we should not do because of experiences from actual implementation of those plans in other cities. So through your extensive knowledge and experience in this field, we have really been able to learn so much. And Swati, we would like to begin a short question answer session. We have a question from Nidhi. I can pass it on to you. Yeah, we have a question from Nidhi, Swati. So,
okay, sure.
Hi, thank you, Swatiji, for the information you provided. I just had one question that you, as you mentioned, that incineration is not a solution, especially in hilly areas. So what can we propose for sanitary waste? Like, what is the other option?
So, you know, Sonam, most of the cities have common biomedical treatment facilities. It could be based in district, if not in all cities. So even across Himachal, one could map which is the nearest common biomedical treatment facility, which takes, hospital waste. And there the sanitary waste could go. So this has been explored in Goa, where a lot of sanitary waste from the city of Panaji goes to the local common biomedical incinerator. Some of it also goes to co-processing facility. In Kerala, in quite a few cities, a lot of sanitary waste goes to the common biomedical incineration facilities. They also have local, those sanitary incinerators, but I'm not sure about their efficiency and quality and if they are not polluting. But I think the safest route is sending it, mapping which are the nearest common biomedical treatment facilities and probably sending it to the one which is closest. They do charge a fee from corporations. So, for instance, we tried to do this for one of the cities in Bihar. And with the city, Muzaffarpur, where I was working, we sort of linked the city to the nearest common biomedical facility. And they were charging like about 12 rupees or something for about 5 kgs. So you could check what is the local rate. But that is like the most doable, safe, environment-friendly option over choosing incineration. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Hello, Swatiji. Thank you so much. It was a very informative session. I do have a question like about segregation at source. like how do we implement it at a place like Dharamshala? Like there's a very low level of awareness and education, both on the side of the people who collect the garbage and on the side of people who, you know, are giving their household garbage to these people. So I think that this is a very huge disconnect that we have in our city.
So Sonam, foremost awareness, like wherever I have worked on interventions in cities where we were working with local corporations, the first thing that you do is create awareness, training of not only staff to collect segregated waste, but also local residents, you know, and ensuring, as I sort of repeatedly said, ensuring that those awareness programs lead to behavior change. So number one is that. Second is probably creating some incentives. I am not sure presently whether households pay user fee in Dharamshala or not, but you could look.
They are.
So probably that element will not pay, but of course awareness works, doing some local, localized interventions work. And if we can create some small scale incentives for people and communities who segregate, I think that would be important. So highlighting that if you give segregated waste, your locality would be more cleaner, or how it will significantly impact the environment if people start giving segregated waste. So I think people do adopt if you address the why and how of things. So doing some community-led programs followed by some incentives. I'm not too okay with providing incentives to people for segregation, because this is something which is not optional anymore. The law says that it is mandatory. So I think one thing which has to be done by the municipal corporation is to publish the bylaws again. Or if they don't have updated the bylaws, ensure that they update the existing solid waste management bylaws, and they put a clause that everyone has to give segregated waste. And then after 1 month of putting it into public portals, also start collecting fines for non-segregation. So also empowering your collectors. In a lot of the best practice cities that I talked about, collectors can fine households who don't segregate, or giving power to your sanitary inspector or some zonal, in charge. So I think decentralization of power, which has worked quite well for Himachal, at least for plastic bans. So something like that could be done for segregation as well. One is making legally binding it to the bylaw, and second, of course, teaching it with awareness programs. Yeah. I hope I was
able. So you're saying that, so you're saying that this has to come basically from the side of the administration?
Both ways. Of course, awareness and behavior change can be done by external agencies. It can be done by NGOs. It can be done by local groups. But the bylaw part, which is strengthening it, including mandatory segregation clauses in it, writing that households have to compulsorily segregate into wet, dry, biodegradable waste. If they don't non-comply from this date onwards, they will be penalized. That part has to come from the administration. Yeah. So if both the education and awareness bit and the strengthening the policy bit and enforcing it on the ground, if both of them sort of work simultaneously, I'm sure, there'll be change on the ground. Yeah. I also want to check with you if Dharamshala has SWM bylaws, and if they have been updated as per the new solid waste management rules.
Yes, ma'am, we have door-to-door garbage collection and transportation rule 2018. We have 54 categories defined. Source segregation ke upar main cheez jo hai, transport and garbage aur penalize. Aur user fees mein hum shuru kar diya hamara yahan, madam, jo user fees hai 45% collection ho raha hai.
Okay.
Par मेजर जो पार्ट है, जैसे आप मैक्रोडोनगंज के एरिया में बात कर रहे हो, मैक्रोडोनगंज एरिया में जो यूजर फीस है वो 10% के आसपास है. और जो मर्ज एरिया दाढ़ी और उस एरिया की 70-80% तक होगी. मींस के ये यहाँ लोग देना नहीं चाहते, ऑलमोस्ट हम लोग जो सैनिटेशन में है इस टाइम 40 लाख पर मंथ जो है स्पेंड कर रहे हैं, तो हमारा जो यूजर मतलब कलेक्शन रेवेन्यू जो है वो है 40 लाख। तो ये एक थोड़ा सा बड़ा सेटबैक है, क्योंकि ट्रीटिंग के ऊपर हम जैसे प्रोसेसिंग के ऊपर जोर दे रहे हैं कि प्रोसेसिंग के ऊपर कैसे इसका मीट आउट करेगा। रहेगा जैसे अब आप बोल रहे थे इसको वेट वेस्ट का, उन जो बल्क वेट जनरेटर है, यहाँ अच्छे अच्छे होटल हैं, हम उन लोगों को बोलते हैं कि आप अपना कंपोस्टिंग यूनिट लगाओ।
बिल्कुल, और उनको
पेपर में लगा दिए,
बिकॉज इतना वो प्रॉफिट कमाते हैं तो दे डेफिनेटली इन्वेस्ट।
और पेपर में उन्होंने मैडम जी लगा दिया है, पर ऑन दी जब हम साइड में उसको चेकिंग करने जाते ऑफ रहता है। तो ये जो थोड़ी सी है, पर जो है सा सारा जो मेट्रोलिटा एरिया जितना भी इसका हुआ है इस एरिया में शुरू कर हम लगे हुए इसमें मीट आउट करने। थैंक यू मैम।
ओके, पर आपको कुछ मुझे ये क्वेश्चन आपसे पूछना था कि आप कुछ प्रेजेंटेशन से कुछ यूजफुल इंटरवेंशन से आइडियाज मिले, कोई ऐसे
नहीं, बहुत फ्रूटफुल मतलब रीयूज रीसाइकल एंड, और इसमें जो आपने जो बेट कंपोस्टिंग वाला जो पार्ट बोला, क्योंकि मेजर चंक जो हुआ
बिल्कुल,
और मोर ओवर जैसे टेक्नोलॉजी बोल रहे हैं, क्योंकि मैं भी यही चीज बोल रहा हूँ कि टेक्नोलॉजी धर्मशाला में तो एटलीस्ट 12 मंथ में 6 मंथ तो रेंजन तो होता है, क्योंकि कोई भी यहाँ चीज वाइबल नहीं। तो आपने जो चीजें सजेस्ट की बहुत अच्छी है, कंपोस्टिंग ऊपर हम करेंगे इसके ऊपर। हाँ, सिंगल यूज के लिए हमने सर मैडम जी आपको शायद मैंने बोला पहले बोला था कि सिंगल यूज के लिए हमने अंबुजा सीमेंट से वो किया हुआ पैक किया, वो हर महीने हमारा 5 या 6 टन जो है उससे थोड़ा सा इम्पैक्ट आया इस चीज के पे, जो डंपिंग शहर के ऊपर जो इफेक्ट मतलब बड़ा वर्डन हो गया। जी,
शुक्रिया।
सो वी हैव प्रोबेबली द लास्ट क्वेश्चन। या, थैंक यू स्वाति। The biggest takeaway for me from this interaction with you is the behavior in that there should be a change behavior. Exactly, because like if you're working for the environment, you have to be able to change the people's behavior. That's the most important as well as the most difficult thing to do, because it has to come from within. So this is something I really would like to work on. Working in a school, the biggest plastic waste is the junk food. So if you, my question is like, if you were the school principal, how would you deal with junk food in a school?
Okay, so when I was with the CSE and for good 10 years, Center for Science and Environment, we had something called a green school program. And under that, we had thousands of school under our radar. And the idea is, and that program is still running. And basically the concept is, how do we make green schools? How do we educate, the future to have, to follow all the things that we are talking about, you know, energy efficiency or less waste footprint, or, making them aware about climate change and how can they contribute. And under that, we had this program of how schools can become zero waste, or how can schools have a better eating, can like push students for better eating habits over junk food. So I would say from all those learnings and my past experience with a few schools where I worked on waste management, one is that ban junk food, completely. I think we need to normalize the culture of or local delicacies that places and cities have to offer. So I think if you want to reduce packaging, don't allow junk food in your canteen. Don't allow chips in your canteen. Also, they are so high on sugar and salt content, and they are so unhealthy that if you are conscious, one shouldn't even allow them. So see how that works. You could also look into converting your school into a zero waste school. And which I mean, to start with, you can cut down on all the single use plastic, which means not allowing kids to have items that are single use, which means they themselves don't get any such items from their home, but at the same time, not making them in the school canteen. So can you work around local food, traditional food, and having those canteen made delicacies offered to students, be it samosa or be it idli and dosa. I remember when we used to go to school, over packaging, these things were available. You know, there was samosa or idli and dosas or vada. But now school canteens have all this packaging laden, chips and other things to offer. So explore if you can ban that, because many schools I know that have adopted this zero waste approach, they don't allow packaged food in their canteens. And probably cut down on single-use plastics completely. You know, you can educate children on the harmful effects of multi-layered packaging. What companies are selling is not product, but pollution and plastic, basically. How much quantity of chips are there in a package of Lay's anyways? You know, so I think you can, and they are easy to turn around. Kids, you know, their minds. And so if you share with them the impact, or probably take them to a site where so many chips packets are lying around and what it does to the environment, I'm sure they'll stop eating it altogether. Yeah. Hope that works. Yeah. Sonam, your microphone is off.
Okay.
Your microphone is off again, Sonam. I'm sorry.
Yes, another question. Yeah. So do you have time?
I can take one question. Yeah. I have to rush for a meeting. So I can take one more.
But yeah, you can answer it in a short way or like in a brief.
Your microphone is mute.
Yes, yes. Swati, yeah. My question is that, yeah, as we are like in India, as we are like spiritual, and like since we are practicing, we Tibetan as a Buddhist, and like the community over here as a Hindu, so under the cultural practices, as being a spiritual, spiritual and like, ritual, yeah, things that we do, as we share the common tradition of like, when we go, when we age and when we pass by, at the crematorium center, when we burn, whole dead body is burned, and the remaining waste from there is, as you know, the like crematorium centers are, like situated near the river streams. So indirectly, from this this point of view, as I'm talking about all the same thing, like, old scriptures as well, people have this dogmatism kind of like kind of consideration in their mind, like we should be burning it instead of, because these scriptures are considered as very sacred. So the one thing that from our office we had did is like we have informed different monastic and nunnery institutions, like even though there is a sacred scriptures as well, you can give it to us. So like at the recycled paper workshop, we are converting it to a fresh recycled product. So this dogmatism, this kind of fear is there because like cultural practices, even though we believe in reincarnation and all these things. So regarding that thing, tying up the wind horse flags, as you know,
yeah,
and these all are, and eventually we are burning it because in the back in our heads, we have this consideration like this should be, kind of like, even though, even it at the end of, even it goes to the incineration plant, somehow it produces some kind of energy instead of burning in the, open air and consider it's a very sacred thing, the very common culture that we share in India. Really, yeah. So my question is how we have to tackle this kind of like waste, cultural waste that we create by our own spirituality and like ritual things that we do.
So you're talking about disposal of the prayer flags,
flags and yes.
Okay.
At the,
so there are a lot of upcycling interventions. I'm not sure if how much of it is in Dharamshala, but can you explore upcycling prayer flags into beautiful craft items which can be utilized? Can it be, some beautiful wall products or curtains or, so try upcycling, because at the end of the day, it's cloth waste. And even if it goes to the land, it will stay there for millions of, hundreds of years. And many a times I see the material of prayer flags, it's not pure cotton. So its biodegradability is very, very low. The material that it's made of is usually nylon or some other material. If it's cotton, you know, probably it's still somewhat good if it goes to the soil. But if it's any other thing like polyester or any other fabric, then it's not good. So one thing is, can you, and this is just very impromptu, but can you explore some upcycling related options here where you can make beautiful artifacts out of peace prayer flags over disposing it? For religious waste, I'm not sure if you're talking about flowers or if you're talking about what other kind of religious waste, but if it's flowers, you know, there's this venture called fool.co that makes these beautiful incense sticks and materials, incense related, out of religious waste. So can you explore that? Flower waste can also be composted, or can be, you know, beautiful compost can be made out of it. So, you know, I mean, there are places that are looking into a lot of options with religious waste. Presently, I would want to keep it brief, but probably I'll send Sonam some material so that she can share with you, wherein you can, you know, look into some of the options. But if it's textile, you can probably try upcycling the you know, the peace flags into some artifacts, if that is possible. Yeah.
Thank you, Swati, for being with us and for joining us for this panel discussion. And
thank
I actually
you.
Also wanted to discuss a little bit further in the area of how the data-driven and data-enabled implementation systems, because as an organization who has very little knowledge, especially in this field, as well as very little authority, so I just wanted to discuss with you ideas about how if we want to do something like this, and if we want to push towards creating a list of vendors or, you know, service providers, there are a lot of people who want to try these sustainable practices, but there is very little knowledge about where to approach and how to, you know, start doing that. So I hope that you'll give us some time, maybe in the emails, following emails or telephone.
Sure.
Later on, that we can learn from you about how to start doing these things and how to who to approach for the data and who to and how to go about it. So I hope you can spare us some time on a later date.
Absolutely, Sonam, not a problem at all. So as you progress forward with it, I'll be more than happy to handhold in my personal time, independently, probably not officially. So I'll be more than happy to take some time to support. Yeah, no worries at that and no problem at all.
Thank you very much, Swati. And I think I'm collectively speaking for all of us here. We are not just the panelist group, but also a group of observers here who will be joining us in the discussion that we'll be having in the afternoon. So it's you. Your talk has been very, very exciting. And we had a lot of information and new ideas from what you have shared. And thank you so much for your time. We are very grateful that you're able to join us today, Swati. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Sonam, and to everyone. I think I loved hearing all the presentations and all the amazing work that is happening on the ground. And I hope sometime soon I'll be able to come down there and see it all. I'm happy to support always. Thank you so much. Bye.
You'll have to let us know if you are here in this area next time.
I will. Yes.
Definitely.
I'm sorry.
Have this opportunity and make something happen.
Yes.
Thank you
definitely.
So much.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you.